Council will come to order. It is 6:02 PM on April the 26th. And the council has a quorum, and Councilmember Jim Perro may not attend tonight because of illness. We are going to go into executive session as soon as I read the following. Pursuant to the following designated sections of the Texas Government Code, annotated Chapter 551, Texas Open Meetings Act, the council will convene into executive session to discuss the following. A, Section 551.074, Personnel Matters, to discuss or deliberate the appointment, employment, evaluation, reassignment, duties, discipline, or dismissal of a public officer or employee, and Section 551.071, 1 and 2, consultation with attorney, seeking advice of its attorney regarding pending or contemplating litigation or a settlement offer, or to consult with the attorney on a matter in which the duty of the attorney of the governmental body under the disciplinary rules of professional conduct of the State Bar of Texas clearly conflicts with the Open Meetings Act. Item 1, Patricia Adams, Town Attorney. It is 6:03 and we are in executive session. We'll come to order. For those citizens who have arrived when we weren't in the room, we were in a closed executive session down in another room, so we thank you for waiting for us. We are reconvening at 11 minutes after 7. And our first item on agenda is item number 2, consider and take appropriate action regarding the executive session. Does anyone wish to make a motion?
I'd like to table the motion until the end of the agenda.
Have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. That was just a little administrative piece that we had to take care of in order to continue our discussion. We didn't want to make you wait till we finished everything in our executive session. Councilmember Perro is not with us tonight because of an illness in the family. And in a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand and we'll be led in an opening prayer by myself. Afterwards, we'll ask you to join us in the pledges to the American flag and the Texas flag. So would you please stand? Gracious God and Creator, we indeed thank you for the manifold blessings that you have given us, especially ones of health and happiness and prosperity, and the opportunity to live in a town whereby we respect each other, that we serve each other, and that we celebrate happiness and quality of life. We ask for your guidance tonight as we deliberate, that we may do so fairly, and that our thoughts would be tempered by your spirit in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
You may be seated. We are now at a point in our meeting for citizens' presentations. This is an opportunity for citizens to address the council on any matter, whether or not it's posted on the agenda. The council is not permitted to take action on or discuss any presentations made to the council at this time concerning an item not listed on the agenda. The council will hear presentations on specific agenda items prior to the council addressing those items. You may speak up to 4 minutes or a time limit determined by the mayor or presiding officer. To speak during this item, you must complete the speaker's form that indicates the topics of your statement. Topics of presentation should be limited to matters over which the council has authority. Hottie, do we have anybody that signed up to speak?
No, Mayor.
So, citizens, this is your chance. If you wanted to address the council on any matter whatsoever, you can fill out a little piece of blue paper over there, give it to Holly, and you have 4 minutes to come address the council. Does anybody wish to do that? All right, thank you very much. There are no speakers tonight. We will go to item number 3 under announcements and reports. Town Manager Saddell's update regarding the following discussions and provide input regarding same. Election day, back to the nature and camp out, community cleanup, Trophy Club Women's Club Garage Sale, and Trophy Club Town Hall. Stephen, you have the floor.
Yes, Mayor and Council and citizens. I would like to share with you a few dates that are coming up. The end of April and May are always busy times, whether it's with school programs or graduations, but we also have a lot of town events happening as well that I'd like to keep you updated on. First is, as you can see, early voting is occurring at the moment, and that started yesterday, and it will conclude next Tuesday, May the 3rd, and you can vote here if you're a Tarrant or a Denton County resident. Election Day is May...
Election Day for Tarrant.
Right.
Yeah.
On Election Day, which is May 7th, Saturday, May 7th, Denton County voters will vote here at the Savore Building. Tarrant County voters will vote in the fire station, the Trophy Club Fire Station. So just make sure that you, if you're Denton County, most 95% of our voters are in Denton County, you would vote here. If you're one of those few voters or residents who live in Tarrant County, you'll vote at the Trophy Club Fire Station. That's again, Saturday, May 7th. Also on Saturday, May 7th is our Back to Nature and our camp out at Trophy Club Park. This is Keep Trophy Wild helps us put this on. It's a great event, especially for kids to come out. Learn a little bit about nature, learn about the environment, learn about Trophy Club Park, learn about our town. And then if you're one of those folks who likes to camp in a tent, then you can come to Trophy Club Park and enjoy that experience. My wife is more of a camp at the Marriott kind of person, so you probably won't see her there. But it's a great time. We always run out of spots, so make sure you register and register early, because there really are a limited number of spaces, and we try to prepare for food and things like that. So lots of fun on both of those events. On May 7th, also that morning, is our community cleanup. This is where it's an opportunity for you to bring bulk items, shredding, household hazardous waste, and electronic recycling. And that will be at Byron Nelson High School on that far west side parking lot, beginning at 9 a.m. It's from 9 to 11. And so it's a short window. It's always very popular. So this is an opportunity to get rid of paints, pesticides. If you have lots of documents you'd like to shred, it's a really good event. But you need to get there early, because many times folks come up and we've already closed down. It's very popular. But there's lots of things. So you can go vote. You can go get rid of your stuff. And you can go learn about nature all in the same day. So it's a busy, busy day. The Trophy Club Women's Garage Sale is this Saturday, April 30th. So if you haven't picked up a permit, contact the Women's Club. They can help you out with that. Are they selling at Tom Thumb?
And Sassy Flamingo.
Both great places. It's a great fundraiser that they do every year. It's a neat event. It's something totally unique to our town. Take advantage of that opportunity. And then finally, May 13th, is the Trophy Club Town Hall groundbreaking. That will start at 5:30 p.m. Just as an update, we will receive bids. Our Steel Freeman, our CMAR, will receive bids a week from today. So May 3rd, they will have all the bid tabs hopefully completed by the 5th or 6th, and we'll have that on our agenda for the May 10th meeting. So we're getting close. So please make plans to attend on Friday, May 13th. Yes, it is Friday the 13th, but it'll be a great time. It's something that's very special. It's the first time that we will actually construct a town hall within the town of Trophy Club, so it's a neat occasion. We're building this facility to last 30, 40, 50 years. It's not something you build every couple of years, so it's a big date in our town's history. I hope you can be part of it. Bring your kids. Breadwinners will be providing some food. Meet You Anywhere will be providing some food. Our spirits store in town has contributed. Tom Thumb has contributed to having some refreshments as well, that are more probably centered on the adults. But please come out, enjoy it, and be part of a special part of our history. Mayor and Council will be happy to answer any questions.
Council, any questions of the report? All right, hearing none, we'll go on to the consent agenda. All matters listed on the consent agenda are considered to be routine by the town council and will be enacted by one motion. There will not be a separate discussion of these items. If discussion is desired, that item will be removed from the consent agenda and will be considered separately. Council, that's items 4 through 8. Does anyone wish to remove an item from the consent agenda? Hearing none, I'll read the items for us to consider. Consider and take appropriate action regarding the minutes dated March 22nd, 2016. Consider and take appropriate action regarding the minutes dated March 29th, 2016. Consider and take appropriate action regarding calling a special town council meeting to be held on May 17th, 2016 at 9 a.m. in the Public Services Conference Room. Item 7, consider and take appropriate action regarding the second town council meeting in May 2016 to be held on May 23rd, 2016 at 7 p.m. in the Savor Municipal Building Boardroom. And item 8, consider and take appropriate action regarding a resolution directing Encore Electric Company, LLC, to file certain information with the Town of Trophy Club, setting a procedural schedule for the gathering and review of necessary information in the connection therewith, setting filing dates, ratifying the hiring of legal counsel and consultants, reserving the right to reimburse the rate case expenses, setting a public hearing for the purposes of determining if the existing rates of are unquestionable, and provide an effective date. I would entertain a motion to approve items 4 through 8 on the consent agenda.
I would like to make a motion to approve consent agenda items 4 through 8.
Have a second?
I'll second.
Moved by Mayor Pro Tem Lamont, seconded by Councilmember Rowe. All in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. Item 9, consider to take appropriate action regarding a proclamation of the Town Council declaring May 5th, 2016 as Day of Prayer and Trophy Club and providing an effective date. I'm going to read a proclamation and I'm going to introduce someone at the end of that proclamation, and I hope people can join us in that celebration and that event. Whereas our nation was founded upon a firm bedrock of faith, and throughout our history, Americans have prayed as a means of seeking comfort, giving thanks, and asking for guidance during times of strength and times of weakness, in moments of joy and moments of despair. And whereas the public prayer and national days of prayer have a long and significant history in American tradition, dating back to the first call to prayer in 1775, when the Continental Congress asked the colonies to pray for wisdom in forming a nation. And whereas these times of national supplication were made official in 1952 by President Harry Truman, signed a joint resolution of the United States Congress, which enacted legislation setting aside an annual day of prayer for the nation. And in 1988, this law was amended permanently, setting the day to be the first Thursday of every May. And whereas the National Day of Prayer belongs to all Americans, and in a day that transcends differences, bringing together citizens to honor God and give thanks to Him for the many liberties and blessings we have received among them, the freedom to gather, worship, and pray. And whereas Thursday, May 5th, 2016, is the 65th observance of the National Day of Prayer with the theme Wake Up America, and inspired by Isaiah 58:1a, which says, "Shout it aloud, do not hold back, raise your voice like a trumpet." And whereas on this day, leaders and citizens across our nation and state will join together to seek the face of Almighty God, to acknowledge our dependence on Him, to seek His grace, guidance, strength, and protection upon us as a people and as a nation, and to pray for peace throughout the world during these trying and challenging times. Now, therefore, I, Mayor C. Nick Sanders, in conjunction with the Town Council of the Town of Trophy Club, Texas, by the power vested in me as Mayor of the Town of Trophy Club, Texas, hereby proclaim Thursday, May 5th, 2016, as a day of prayer and Trophy Club to coincide with the National Day of Prayer, and this proclamation shall take effect from and after this date of passage in accordance with the law, and is so proclaimed. Do I have a motion to approve this proclamation?
So moved.
Councilmember Reed, do I have a second?
I'll second.
Councilmember Rowe seconded. All in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. At this time, I'd like to introduce Irma Thomas, who is in the back, and ask her to come forward to the podium. Irma, I'll give you a chance to say a few words. I wanted to say how long you've been heading this Upham Trophy Club, but I knew that I would have it wrong. So I'll ask you that first question. How long have you been heading up National Day of Prayer and Trophy Club?
This will be the 24th observance.
All right. Congratulations, and thank you very much. Anything else you'd like to say?
I just wanted to let everybody know that you are all welcome to come to the National Day of Prayers next Thursday, May 5th, next week. It will be held in the Fellowship United Methodist Church starting at 12 noon. We'll go to 1 o'clock, and we're going to have the Honor Guard from Roanoke Fire Department. They'll be presenting the colors, and we'll have the Veterans of Foreign Wars leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. And the mayors of our town, of course, and Westlake and Roanoke will be there to read their presentations and declaring it a time of prayer in their city. This is an important time for our nation, and we really need to stop and pray, you know, during these turbulent times that we experience and lean on God and our faith. And so I welcome you all to come and join us.
Irma, I have a proclamation for you. So we're going to get a picture here, but we're going to stand sideways because all we have is voting machines.
Okay.
You're okay. We'll manage this.
Thank you
so much. For years, we held that event at the clock tower out in the weather. And some years it was freezing cold, other years it was hot, and some years it was raining. And last year was the first time we went inside, and we went to the Methodist Church that invited us and, of course, was close by to the clock tower. I think this year the planning must be, as the weather has been so unstable, we might as well just plan for the Methodist Church because odds are we might be there anyway. But thank you and hope you'll show up for that. Item number 10, consider and take appropriate action regarding accepting the nominations from the committee and recognizing the 2015 Citizen of the Year nominees and announcing the recipients and discussion of same. So I now put my sheet away that I had earlier. Citizens, I welcome you to a town council meeting. The young people, I guess you're going to get a civics lesson, if that's what it's called, maybe, and how administration of government happens in a community, and there'll be a test before you leave. Is that okay? No, we're paying attention? No, okay. It's a test just for the adults because we know that you were paying attention. This is really a great time. Our town has a history of volunteerism. For as long as I've been here, which is 20 years, and long before that, there was a lot of volunteerism, and we really appreciate everybody that puts forth the effort to help others in this town. Tonight, we're pleased to present certificates of gratitude to all the people that were nominated for Citizen of the Year, both in the adult category and in the youth category. The council doesn't choose these people. These are people nominated by citizens, and recipients of the previous awards each year for both adult and youth actually make the decision of who should get the award. So it's totally non-political in that case. So I appreciate that very much. Each of the people nominated have contributed tremendously to what says Trophy Club is a great place to live. And the town council and myself and the town manager, Steven Seidel, and all of the staff appreciate what you do to make things work well and to allow the citizens to enjoy this beautiful community. We could not do it without the volunteers. You, those of you who are being recognized tonight have put forth an effort that said to people that knew you that you go above and beyond what's really required. And so what we're going to do tonight is we're going to read a little information about each candidate and announce who the person is that's winning the award tonight. We'll do the adults first and then the youth. And the information that's going to be read is really the words of the people who made the nomination. So it's not our words. It's not necessarily a bio. It's what people thought about you who might be receiving an award. And even though you may not be the person who receives the Citizen of the Year award, you are being recognized by your brothers and sisters in the town, and we do have a certificate for you. So at this time, I would recognize Councilmember Schaffner to read the adult information.
And just keep in mind, like the mayor said, these are not our words. These are the words of those who submitted the application. So if it sounds a bit odd, you just forgive us.
So as he announces your name, when he finishes reading, I'm going to ask you to come up, go over here on my left, your right, and sneak by the election machines and stand up in front for us, okay? So go ahead.
The first nominee is Matt Tibbetts, who has lived in Trophy Club over 10 years. Matt has been a volunteer benefiting Trophy Club for many years, putting in countless hours benefiting children, parents, and families. He serves as the president of the local recreational soccer association, Greater Northwest Soccer Association, and has worked to provide the youth of Trophy Club a valuable and fun soccer program. He has coached, served on the board, and over the last few years has been president of the association. He works with the town to ensure fields are in the best shape possible. He also works with the volunteer coaches, helping them learn how to be great coaches, and works with the referees by providing guidance and direction. He shows up at the fields almost every day, getting the fields ready for games and hosting practices or assisting other coaches. In this role, he is a representative of Trophy Club among the other cities in the DFW area. Matt does all this while raising his children, caring for his wife during sickness, and working two jobs over many years. Matt has always been willing to go out of his way to help whenever asked. He will drop what he is doing without mentioning the inconvenience. And these are my words. I have two kids in soccer, two twins that are 7 years old, and we really appreciate, our family appreciates everything that you do, Matt. Lou Hawker is the next nominee. He has lived in Trophy Club 13 years. Lou annually puts in a few hundred hours as a volunteer for the town. Many times my family and I have driven through Trophy Club Park and have seen Mr. Hawker hauling bags of trash and debris that he has personally cleaned up. He clears brush, trees, etc. to keep the parks and trails looking nice. He is at the park year-round, working extremely hard, doing many times back-breaking volunteer work. He was also instrumental in helping to organize the cleanup of Trophy Club Park, which helped the town obtain its match with FEMA. Lou has served for 6 years on Park Board and is also on the Trophy Club Park Subcommittee. This alone is a major time commitment. He will consistently volunteer for any jobs or tasks, whether it be park-related or not. Lou is an ambassador of goodwill to everyone he interacts with and represents the town well. I was always so impressed with his dedication when I served with him. Lou has distinguished himself as a person who is deeply committed to making Trophy Club Park, the Parks and Rec Department, and the town a better place to volunteer. Lou's efforts are guided by a desire to promote volunteering, which has ultimately improved the park's operation and cleanliness. It's very difficult to list all the activities he's been involved with over the years, since he's been involved with so many. In 2012, Lou worked tirelessly to assist in developing Trophy Club Park's trail system. He volunteered hundreds of hours cleaning trails, constructing water crossings, and meeting with staff. In 2014, Lou became the town volunteer liaison for the Eagle Scout projects. Since 2014, 8 projects have been completed. Projects include the construction of critter-proof trash cans, disc golf signs, an outdoor classroom, a boardwalk, trail crossing signs, and building improvements. Lou's strong commitment to these projects have positively impacted the park, which has led to an overwhelming amount of project requests from Eagle Scouts. In 2015, Trophy Club Park received a record amount of rain, which in turn led to severe flooding. Over 90% of the park was affected. As the water began to recede, Lou was instrumental in leading initiatives to restore the park. Lou led multiple volunteer cleanups and also assisted staff with documenting flood damage required by FEMA. Lou is willing, intentional volunteer who gives with all his heart to Trophy Club Park and the community. And then the last nominee is Kelly Castanway. She's lived in Trophy Club for 13 years. Kelly works tirelessly for the community, volunteering time and great effort to make our town better. She is an incredibly dedicated Trophy Club citizen who works every day to make Trophy Club a better place to live. Kelly devotes many hours of her personal time volunteering to help Trophy Club remain a welcoming and beautiful community for all of us who live here. In the 2 years that I have known her, Kelly has been involved in several community projects. She volunteered to be a member of Trophy Club's 30th birthday committee for the year of 2015, and she regularly attended the weekly and bi-weekly Monday night meetings. In conjunction with the committee, Kelly spent countless hours preparing for and volunteering at the foundation dinner in January, the extravaganza in March, the fourth parade in July, the fall festival in October, and the Christmas celebration in December. In addition, Kelly volunteered to be a member of the 4th of July Parade Committee, which worked independently of the 30th Committee, and met once a month with the Parade Committee from February to July. She showed up at Byron Nelson by 5 a.m. and played an integral role in every step of the parade, from registering runners for the 5K to cheering on every runner as she crossed the finish line, to organizing the floats as they prepared to enter the parade, to walking in the parade, to helping clean up after the parade. In addition, she took the lead on flag planting for several of Trophy Club streets to help support the Stars and Stripes Committee. Not one to shy away from freezing cold weather or unbearably hot weather, Kelly volunteered to sell tickets and t-shirts for a variety of events by sitting outside of Starbucks no matter the weather. She was such an integral part of the 4th of July committee that she is now serving as a co-chair on this year's 4th committee. She is also extremely active volunteer with Snowball Express, a wonderful charity that supports children who have had a parent die while on active duty in the military. Kelly inspires service, and several people have volunteered their time once Kelly informed us of an opportunity. In addition to her major work on these committees, Kelly continues to show up and support a wide variety of Trophy Club activities. For example, she has spent Saturday mornings cleaning up the Veterans Memorial. She has shared breakfast with Trophy Club veterans. She has shown up for the Medal of Honor motorcade in the past 2 years. She has supported the Women's Club. She is an active member of the Trophy Club Kickball League, and she has most recently joined the Trophy Club Bocce Ball League. There are very few people who have spirits as generous and kind as Kelly. She loves Trophy Club, and she is always around with a smile on her face, ready to help out where she can and to cheer on those who work around her. Never one to seek the spotlight herself, she has done all this to help our community, and people like Kelly help make our great town.
So at this time, I would invite Matt, Lou, and Kelly to please come forward. You'll have to come around the voting machines by going to your right, and be careful about the cable, and stand up here, and we have a certificate. And at this time, I would announce the person who is receiving the Adult Citizen of the Year as from the committee, and it is Kelly Castaway. So congratulations. Oh. Everybody stay here, and we're going to get a picture. How are you going to do that you don't get voting machines, right? What do you want us to do?
In the middle.
Jane.
Go to the middle. All right, good. All right. Kelly, congratulations. Thank you very much.
Big guy.
So I've asked Councilmember Ryland Rowe to read the information about the young people, and then we'll announce the person receiving that award. Rylan?
Yes, sir.
First, we have Riley Murray, who is 8 years old. Riley seems to everyone as a typical 8-year-old girl. However, she was born with a congenital heart defect where her right ventricle never developed, and her major arteries were transposed, needing 3 major surgeries beginning at 7 days old to reroute her blood flow. She fights every day to keep up with others, whether it's in school, dance, or on the soccer field. She doesn't let this stop her, though. You couldn't meet a more compassionate girl who befriends all. She loves to dance, play with her toys, and to help others. She was in Girls on the Run and was even able to run a 5K in an impressive 54 minutes. During practice, she would go back and encourage others who were struggling, showing her compassion. One thing she does to improve awareness of CHD is to talk at events. She's spoken at health fairs, including the one at Texas Motor Speedway. She works with her friends and family to get donations to provide to parents of children in the hospital at Medical City Dallas Children's Hospital. She promotes the Jump Rope for Heart by collecting a large number of donations year after year. Second, we have Braylee Crouch, who's 13 years old. From a very early age, Braylee has embraced others' differences, showing compassion and a heart for helping others in need. When Braylee moved to Trophy Club in fourth grade, she shared her kindness and compassion with the students in Lakeview Elementary School's structured learning classroom, which includes students with severe physical and mental disabilities. She was instrumental in helping her school counselor implement a peer buddy program at Lakeview. Bobcat Buddies is a program designed to pair general education students with the SLC students. Even after Braylee moved on to middle school, the program continued to thrive and eventually was named as a 2015 Promising Practice Award winner by Character.org. Braylee has continued to show her true colors and passion by teaching and coaching individuals with special needs. One of the nonprofit organizations that she's involved in is Super Kids. This organization is a league for the mentally and or physically challenged children and adults that offers basketball, baseball, football, and cheerleading. Braylee coaches adults between the ages of 18 and 50 with varying disabilities within this organization. She teaches cheer, dance, and sidelines. Braylee is also involved with her own competitive cheer squad, Champions All-Stars, but still manages to volunteer her time within this organization. She assists with the non-competitive team of athletes with an intellectual disability and or physical disability, ranging in ages from 6 to 30. This year alone, she assisted them in 8 competitions. She's also helping the leadership team, a class offered through Champions, by teaching others the skills to be a leader. Braylee also volunteers her time helping her mother, an NISD special education teacher, and also with the annual Grand Ball at Byron Nelson High School. You'll find her organizing, decorating, and helping at the big event for our special education students, but more importantly, you'll see her out there dancing right along with the students. Braylee is one of those students who's never met a stranger. She's the first to flash you her smile and a big hello when you enter the building. She's always very welcoming to new students to our school. Last year when we had a new student begin at Medlin, Braylee was the first to show her around and make her feel welcomed. Braylee looked past this student's physical disability and became a true friend. This year, when our Medlin family experienced the loss of this particular beloved student, Braylee, along with a couple of her classmates, stepped up to organize ways to honor and celebrate her life. As a Medlin community, we joined Braylee and her classmates one Sunday evening for a balloon release in this student's honor. Braylee is an exceptional eighth grader that has a pure heart for helping others in need. She's very humble and never looks for recognition for her good deeds. On average, Braylee volunteers 5 to 10 hours a week on top of her own cheerleading commitments, academic demands, and spending time with family and friends. She still manages to maintain A's and B's in all of her academic courses. And third, we have Scott Hopps, who is 17 years old. Scott is a leader, academically driven, and volunteers in many ways in our community. Scott is ranked 2nd in the senior class of 566. His academics, school clubs, and athletics are only a part of what he excels in. Scott's a member of the National Honor Society, National Math Honor Society, serving as vice president as well as receiving the Byron Nelson Lead Motto Award in his junior year. This award is given to the top male and female student for exceptional leadership and character. The Lead Award alone exemplifies what type of person Scott Hopps is or has become. Scott is involved in football and has been on varsity, playing offensive lineman for the past 2 seasons. He also participates on the academic UIL teams for math and science. Scott is currently the president of the Future Business Leaders of America, where he has advanced to the national competition in Chicago after receiving first place in the state of Texas. Not only is Scott actively involved in clubs and athletics within our school, Scott has also written for the school newspaper, participated in anti-bullying school programs, and performed in many theater productions. Community service and volunteering opportunities often fill Scott's summers and weekends. He volunteers as a counselor at his church's Vacation Bible School every summer, where he works directly with children in their Bible lessons. He's also active in his church youth group, the Link Leader Program at BNHS, and he tutors students in calculus, pre-cal, algebra 2, physics, and chemistry. Scott is truly an exceptional young man that will make a mark on our world. He sees the big picture. He's well-rounded, generous of his time, and works incredibly hard. He's a born leader who is persistent, and his character shines through in all that he does.
All right, at this time I'd like to ask Riley and Braley and Scott to please come forward. Watch your step as you go past the cord there. At this time, I would like to announce the person receiving the Youth Citizen of the Year Award is Scott Hopps. Scott, congratulations. So congratulations to you. If y'all step over there to the middle, we're going to get a photograph. And I'm going to, you're okay right there. I'm just going to grab this piece of paper. All right, so let's get a picture. And I'm sure parents and people want it. We get them? Not one more. Two more. All right, congratulations very much. Now, they probably didn't tell you that when you win the Youth Citizen of the Year Award and when you're nominated, that means that we expect you to stay in the town the rest of your life. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the way. So, and I want to tell everybody that was a nominee and a participant and their parents and friends that on May the 20th, which is a Friday, at 6 p.m., I believe, is that right, Stephen?
Yes.
6 p.m. at the Country Club, we're going to have a volunteer appreciation reception. We ask you to come to that, enjoy the fellowship of other volunteers in town. Everyone will be getting an invitation for that, and hopefully you'll reserve that date and come back and celebrate with everybody. So thank you very much. Congratulations. We want a picture of everybody, adult and you. We have to make you come back.
Council, can y'all
come around?
Up right where you're at, and staying up there is fine. But kind of framing this town seal.
Sure, have me behind the big guy.
Nobody. Yeah, right.
No, it's standing behind him.
Yeah, that picture would be great.
No, no, stand up.
This way.
Stand up tall.
Come on, in here. Kelly, come on.
Ooh.
Okay, Scott,
all right.
This way, Smidge. Where, Miss Kelly?
Well,
Air Potemica.
Wait a minute, one more, I think. Two more.
Okay, let's just get our two recipients. With council, keep standing for me. Good job, nominees.
You're trying to get in front of Greg, is that what you're trying to
do? Okay, Greg, I can't see you now.
Perfect.
Perfect.
There we go.
And one of just them. Oh. Okay, one of the two of them. Stay there.
Can we move?
Anybody just want the two? Want to get one of just
can we move?
Just the two, right?
You want us or
no? No, I don't want the council in this at all.
Perfect.
Tough.
No, that's good. Thank you very much. Congratulations to you. Council, thank you. So before everybody runs out, because I know that's what you're getting ready to do, the storms are still way away. We've been watching them, watching the radar, so there's no fear. You'll get home before they...
My wife has been texting me.
Everybody's been doing this. At this time, I would entertain a motion that we receive the nominations and those that receive the awards tonight. Would someone please move that we receive those and name Kelly and Scott as the recipients?
Yeah, I'd make a motion that we receive the nominations for Trophy Club Citizen of the Year and Youth Citizen of the Year and name Scott Hopps, Trophy Club Youth Citizen of the Year, and Kelly Castingway, Trophy Club Citizen of the Year.
You have a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Kurtz. I think that's who I heard first. All in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. Wait a minute, you can't vote in the back.
Can't get to it.
I'm voting for her.
Oh, okay. You're just a little slow on that. I thought you were voting again. All right, thanks everyone, and it does pass. So if you want to stay, you're welcome to stay for our next items, or if you want to go, we'll give you a chance to leave.
Take a minute.
Yeah, take a break.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you for everything.
Thank you, everybody.
Did you say we can go, Nick?
Take a break.
You need to go. Okay, so we'll take a short recess.
I'm just saying if we can go, I'm going to.
No, you're not going. Do you need a recess?
Yeah. No.
All right, some people need a recess, so it's 9 minutes to eight. And we are on item 11, discussion and recommendation regarding approval of site plan for the new Trophy Club Town Hall facility located at 1 Trophy Club Drive on Lot 4, Block B, Trophy Wood Business Center, case SP-16-036. Now, there's a staff report, a site plan, and some exhibits. Stephen, did you want to say anything before I have Ron talk?
Well, this is just the culmination of a lot of work over the last year plus, and it's exciting to finally be here. As I mentioned earlier, we'll be going to bids, or we're at bid right now, and we should receive those back next week. We're working on some of the final design aspects of the brick and things like that, but overall, the site plan is prepared and ready for consideration. I'll turn this over to Ron for any type of specific overview and details from the P&Z.
All right, Ron, do you want to comment upon what P&Z did and the site plan?
Thank you, Mayor. The Planning and Zoning Commission, well, let me just give you a little bit of the background of the issues that they discussed. First of all, the Town's Code of Ordinances requires any new building to be approved through a legislative site plan approval by the Town Council, which is why this is coming before you. This is a little different than past discussions from the Council in that this is just approving the actual requirement that the council approve the building that would be incumbent on anybody that wants to build a building, new building in the town, whether it be the town or it be a private developer. So that's why this is in front of you. And it differs a little bit from past discussions on the actual style, the design of the building and funding, and that this is just fulfilling that requirement. So with that, because this is fulfilling that legislative requirement, it must meet all the Code of Ordinances requirements, the property zone GU, government use. And there is one issue that is not in compliance with those requirements, and that would be the rear screening fence. There's an 8-foot masonry screening fence required between residential and non-residential properties. That is not shown on the plan and is not proposed for construction. Therefore, a waiver would need to be granted. P&Z approved this conditional with that waiver being granted. In other words, they did approve or recommend approval of that waiver being granted on that rear screening wall. Also, there was a requirement that the dog run that is shown in the site plan contain a wrought iron fencing material. Chain link is shown now on the site plan. So those were the conditions that were approved by the P&Z on this plan. I'll be glad to answer any questions from the council.
All right, thank you. So just as a reminder for council, when you move approval of the site plan, You might want to include dealing with the screening wall, I guess is what it's called. Is that right?
That would be, yes, screening wall.
Yeah. So whether or not you want to require it or provide an exception for that.
And Mayor, if you give me just a brief moment, I can pull up the site plan for you on this the podium computer.
I had a couple of questions, so I'll just start with that. I'm not sure if council have some of those or not. Currently, there is a fence that's the back fence for all the property owners on Hannah Court. Do we know if that actually sits on the property line, therefore we share the fence, or, and Nick, maybe you're going to answer that for us.
This was discussed at the P&Z meeting. Majority of the columns are on the citizens' property as opposed to the town hall property.
All right, good. And then did we have any citizens attend the P&Z meeting that met on this item that live on Hannah Court?
No, sir.
All right. And I understand there was some discussion about the dog run fence, and that's the item you brought up. And that was a recommendation to make it wrought iron. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And I have some comments on that.
All right, good. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted a clarification on page 48 of your packet that has the site plan. Council, in our previous discussions, if you remember, we took action in order to save some money to remove a series of parking spots. They are shown on the site plan because if in the future we wanted to add them, they need to be approved to be able to allow that. Is that right?
There is a point of clarification on that. So, and Nick, just help me out on this if I say this incorrectly, but the parking that's shown on the site plan, it actually displays the reduced parking.
Oh, it does. Okay.
Yes. That is correct.
All right. So I had that wrong. Okay. All right. So I just wanted to clarify what we were looking at. I was just confirming, have you got to the point that anything displays yet?
We have it plugged in, and now we just need to pull it up.
So if I'm looking at the same page, page 48 of your packet, it's titled Site Plan, and at the very top is where we have the proposed dog run and site for the backup generator, I guess. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
That is correct.
And behind that, it says fence to wall modular. Well, the wall is modular block, but all along the back of the property and to the left, there's a fence, and that's a wrought iron fence on top of the wall or something?
On top of the wall, there is a 42-inch fence that runs along this retaining wall.
The solid line with the small X's in it,
yes.
If anybody's wondering.
Yeah, a little hard to kind of see some of that at our size, but you can blow up and kind of see it. I just am confirming.
That's mandatory for safety, I think, mm-hmm. Isn't it?
Yeah, because
yes.
Of the drop-off.
Yeah, we do not want somebody coming down on the other side of that.
All right, and so was the proposal for P&Z to make the dog run entirely wrought iron?
Yes.
And
yes.
Separate it from the generator, is my assumption.
Not to separate it from the generator. It's just wrought iron.
It was strictly a material recommendation for the fence.
But the dog run wouldn't be in the same area of the generator. Wouldn't it be separated by a fence?
Yes. It would have a fence.
Yeah,
there would
be a fence. Right. Between
what my assumption is. Okay.
Between the pad. So, sorry.
All right. Okay. So, Philip said he had some questions, and I see Greg has some questions. All right.
I did, too. I set up a meeting and spoke with Susan, who is the chair of our animal control board, and with Kelly Aiken, our animal control officer. And they both recommended that we keep this chain link and not wrought iron, just because of the fact that, one, if you just do the traditional wrought iron like you have at Harmony Park, dogs will squeeze through, mm-hmm. things of that nature. So I would make the suggestion that we follow that advice and keep that chain link. You know, we might consider down the road a black type or some kind of screen or something like that, but I would say that we keep that chain link. The question that I had is we've made this the animal control part very user friendly for our volunteers, so that if a volunteer comes up, they have access to that section, all right? And we've also made it user friendly for citizens who might lose a dog to come up and to get to that corner. The problem that we've done is if we ever go back, and I think eventually we will at some point perhaps, or we have to at least think that we're going to plan to a security fence, do we want those, are we going to give access to those volunteers to go through that security fence and to that dog run? Or is that something that we would potentially keep them out of that area?
No, we would give them access.
Okay.
Either through a key stored in the kennel area or badge access.
Okay. Because the reason I was saying that, I don't know if it wouldn't be better to go across that parking lot and into that field area, which is behind the Holiday Inn, behind that wall, somewhere over in that area where those trees are, here. As right where they would walk through. I don't know. When you look at it, you don't really know where it's obviously wherever you put this is going to be quite a bit distance from the actual. We probably in hindsight probably should have put the animal part in the back somewhere, just because it gives more access to the dog run. The problem, I guess, is if they have a dog who, this is from what I understand, if they have a dog that they need to separate and put in the dog run, there's really no visual of to see that dog. If they're having to clean the animal facility for whatever reason because of that dog, you know, some sort of accident or something. And so, but I looked at the plans at home, and there really wasn't a good place to put it in correlation to where the actual animal shelter is. And so it may be where it's at is probably the best location at this point.
All right. And I think Greg and then Rylan.
Or Garrett.
Or Garrett and me. Mm-hmm. All right, Greg.
Basically what Philip said, I was at the P&Z meeting, and they more or less looking at aesthetics, not the issues of the dog protection.
Right. All right, Garrett.
I'm glad, Susan, you like chain link, because I was going to say I don't want to pay for a wrought iron fence for a dog run. You weren't going to get my vote on that one. But you did bring up a point, Philip, that makes me want to ask a question. So the front corner down there is where the animal, yeah, so right there. So if somebody comes to pick up their lost dog, what is the likelihood, and I don't know how operationally this works. See, my understanding was they would be in a kennel up there. The dog run is not, so somebody wouldn't come to pick up their dog. We're like, oh, it's out in the dog run. It would be, so the dog run, the purpose of that is to get them out.
I mean, if it's used basically to give the dogs a little bit of room to stretch their legs and basically cleaning for health reasons. Because mm-hmm. we're inside today, we're all outside. So to hose it down, to clean it out in case they defecate or vomit, gotcha. That kind of stuff.
Okay.
To get them out of there while we have a safe environment to clean.
Okay. Yeah, we probably, if we would have, in hindsight, should have flipped that around and made it more convenient for the animal control officer. But
if you don't mind me interjecting, I'll
give
you kind of the
as
thought
as long
process.
As it's chain link, you can say that.
I'm not going to comment on that at this point. These two doors that are located in this area, when we had the masonry screen wall in, it allowed for the chief to have a little bit more control over what was happening at the animal control area. Mm-hmm. The door to the farthest south was the door that was going to be used by the volunteers and anybody picking up their dog.
Okay.
So they didn't have to be associated with the secured lot at that point. And the door to the rear is where the chief staff would be coming in, as well as the animal control officer. Okay. So the initial intent was that they would be the one taking the dog out to the dog run, not the volunteers or anybody else.
Perfect.
Oh, so that changes things then.
but It allowed the chief to have full control on that.
Yeah, and the way we envision it is on the weekends or when she's not around, does the volunteers have access to just two parts of the three-part animal control area, the storage room and the animal holding area itself, and then they could run it out to the run if they felt they needed to.
Okay. Because, I think our intention is to get this more volunteer-friendly so that your guys aren't doing as much as what maybe they're doing today.
And one reason why, we're talking about maybe we should have moved things around, one of the reasons why it's in that corner is so that people could easily access and walk directly to there and pick up their pet and then leave without, having to go a long distance.
All right, so I had one citizen sign up to speak, and that's Susan Edstrom, if you want to come forward.
So, Susan Edstrom, 269 Oak Hill Drive. As Philip mentioned, Kelly and I met on Saturday, and there were a couple of things. So, safety, number one, of the animals that are there, but also making sure that smaller animals can't get in so that Kelly or I, walking the dogs late at night and in the dark. I don't know if anybody thought about that, but dogs have to be taken out fairly frequently, at a minimum every 4 hours. So they can be left overnight, but typically when I watch them over the weekend when Kelly's gone, I go at 10 o'clock and let the dog out so that he or she can relieve themselves before they go to bed. Don't know, just want to make sure there's lighting back there, because right now where the shelter is, I will not go by myself at 10 o'clock at night. It's pretty scary. I've come fairly close to a coyote back there one evening, so I don't go by myself. All I want to make sure of is that there's good lighting there so that when the volunteers do take the dogs out, they have to be taken out. They're not like cats. They can't be left alone with a litter box all day. They've got to be taken out. I have a quick question about the generator pad. What's on there? Is that going to run all day?
No. It's an emergency generator.
Just want to make sure. Because today, the hot air blows on the animals all day long. So I just wanted to make sure we weren't having the same situation. It's the first time I've seen it blown up and I saw a generator. So when we met with Kelly, there's a couple things. When we did the dog park, I don't know if you guys remember, but the chain link fence actually goes into the ground to also prevent dogs from digging out. Mm-hmm. So if Kelly has to put a dog in the dog run and go back into and clean it up, sometimes that can take 20 to 30 minutes. If a dog has been sick, if a dog has diarrhea, the bleach has to sit on that floor for a minimum of 15 minutes to ensure that all of the germs are taken out. Sorry for the graphic description there. So that dog would be out there for 15, 20 minutes. And if you've got a digger, if you have beautiful wrought iron fence, that's great, but a good dog will be out of that in about 5 minutes. So there were safety and security reasons. Ideally, Kelly would have liked it so that she would have, a quick visual out the door to look at the dog. I don't think she has that with this situation, but I think, and I just want to make sure that we've got the hookup for the washer and dryer, we've got the storage basin, everything that she needs, and I want to make sure that volunteers. They are going to need to have access to the storage, to the dogs, and to the dog run.
Right.
So I just want to make sure that I know, Chief, you just said what's inside. They've got to be able to get the animal outside, particularly if they've got to clean something up like Kelly would.
All right. Thank you, Susan. Thanks. So, Council, this is just a site plan approval. We're not dealing with specifics inside the building or the building itself. We're really just approving the site plan. So anybody else have any other questions? I have one, but I'll wait. So, Rylan?
I'll just say I agree about the chain link for the digging, and I have wrought iron, and I'm close to core property, and so I have lots of visitors coming in, more so than I have worry about my little old lady dog getting out. But in either case, aesthetics are – I completely understand where P&Z was going, but in this case, function has to trump that. So I would support sticking with the chain link.
So, Ron, my question deals with the tree survey and the number of trees that are being taken out that are on what I'm going to call the back of the property, which is the property that's closest to the Hannah Court homes. As we see this, now that we see the tree locations and the building location and the existing road and where utility relocation is, There weren't very many trees back against their fence anyway, were there? Because of the old road.
Correct.
So we're really, if I go to that page, let me, I think that's 47 maybe, that shows the removal of the trees.
Yes, that's
correct. Oops, wrong way.
Is it the dark outline trees that are being removed, or are those the ones being kept?
Those are the ones being removed, the okay. dark.
So really along their fence line, nothing's being removed.
That is correct.
And there are a few that are towards the building, and obviously those that are under the building, so to speak. But most of those trees, to what I'm going to say the upper left for us, seems like a number of trees being preserved there. If I'm reading this right, is that right?
That is correct.
Anybody else have a question? If not, I would entertain a motion to approve the site plan and make a decision about the screening wall and the fence around the dog run.
Let's
Anyone
see.
Wishing to make a motion?
Do we have a note? Yeah, I'll make a motion to approve the site plan for the new Trophy Club Town Hall facility located at 1 Trophy Club Drive on Lot 4, Block B, Trophywood Business Center, case SP16036, to include granting a waiver for the screening wall requirement on the north boundary of the property adjacent to residential property, as recommended by Planning and Zoning, and to retain the chain link fence for the dog run as specified in the plan.
Do you have a second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion or questions? Any citizen input? Didn't see anybody try to sign up, but give you a chance. All right. All in favor of the motion to approve the site plan, granting a waiver for the sound wall exception and retaining the chain link fence as designed, please show your hands.
For clarification, screening wall, not sound wall.
Oh, did I say sound wall? Well, that's
you got TxDOT on the brain.
Yeah, I did. Okay. I wrote screening wall, but okay. All right. All those in favor of approving the motion to approve the site plan, granting the exception for the screening wall, and retaining the chain link fence as designed, please show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. All right, thank you, everybody.
You're welcome.
No problem.
And Ron, thanks for keeping me straight.
Not a problem.
All right. Item 12, discussion and provide direction to staff regarding aesthetics for the Texas Department of Transportation TxDOT sound wall along State Highway 114, discussion of same. We do have Nancy Klein, who is here, who's the area engineer. Nancy, kind of wave at us so we... Everybody knows, and Nelson Underwood, who's chief design engineer, who are here about that. Ron, do you want to talk about the recommendation and what we're doing here?
Yes, briefly, this is really just to get final direction from the council on the aesthetics of the wall as the part of the wall that would face Highway 114. Today, we sent a letter to the residents that back up to the wall. These are the same residents that were notified by TxDOT as to whether or not they even want the wall. We did get a majority of them reply back that they do in fact want the wall, and there were no replies that did not want the wall. So we are now polling them on the aesthetics, and what you have in your packet is the same thing we've sent to the residents in terms of options. So the two options are related to wall texture, and the second one is wall color. There are three options, and these are from TxDOT. And these were presented at the February 9th meeting to the council. Fractured fin, brick, and ashlar stone, which are the texture options. And then the color options, actually the town can really choose any color it wants. What we gave to the residents as options, and this is based on the color scheme that exists on Highway 114 that you see the overpasses painted. It's kind of a tannish color. Actually, the town of Westlake informed me that it's called Town Hall Tan. And then there's a darker, kind of a chocolate-colored brown. And then we also have a light gray and a dark gray option that may work better with the stone if that's something that the council chose. So those are the same options that were sent to the residents. We have a deadline to get their responses back through an online survey that we posted no later than next Wednesday. And then we need to turn that around and get TxDOT the final preferences no later than May the 10th. The letting date for the project is in July. Therefore, the final 100% designs are very close to being done, pending us forwarding to the TxDOT design team what we want to see the wall look like. So we do have TxDOT representatives here that can answer questions, and I'll be glad to answer any questions as well.
All right. I think in our previous meetings about this, some council didn't necessarily care and didn't make remarks about what it looked like. But this is your chance to speak out. My preference is the ashlar stone as far as the how it looks. Does anybody else want to express a preference?
Let's see what page they're on.
It's
page 81, I think.
It's basically subject to what the residents decide, right?
No, this is the 114 side.
This is the external side.
The residents have an interior option that is voted upon the majority rules, and then there's the exterior part that you will make a recommendation on.
I would go agree with the stone too.
Yeah, same.
Now, when I looked at Westlake, their wall seemed to have, I'm going to call it just a flat concrete border along the top ends and bottom, and it was almost a white. Maybe it wasn't white, but so there was a huge contrast. Would this wall have that same kind of border, or is it mostly all the way to the top? So one of you want to answer that?
We refer to that description as coping. And the contractor always likes to propose to remove it because they save money if they don't have it. But we recognize that it adds some definition to the wall. So it's really your request.
Okay. I didn't like the coping. That was just me.
See, and it's all really personal as to what you...
It means that the stone look goes all the way to the top and all the way to the edges, as opposed to it seems like it's framed in a coping. But
I guess I like the framing.
You like the framing.
The way it is now.
Somebody else make a comment.
I think the ashlar stone. I like the ashlar stone.
Coping or no coping?
I don't care about the coping. I don't.
Okay.
I'm not a big coping fan, but...
Same.
Okay, so ashlar stone seems to be the comments of the majority of council, and it seems like the majority was no coping. Did I interpret that correctly?
I think Schottner is the deciding vote.
Schottner didn't say anything.
He's the deciding vote on that one, I think.
No, I don't like the coping.
Oh, okay.
I don't even know what it is.
But. All right, so we are... providing direction without a motion here. And so, Stephen, you understand that ashlar stone seems to be the majority of the choice without coping. And as far as color, if you wanted to stay with the color, what Westlake was doing,
mm-hmm.
I'm not sure the color for Westlake is represented here, but
it's not an exact match. It would be a little bit different than what you have.
It would always be different, yeah. Nobody's going to see it side by side, right?
That's correct.
Okay. Anybody have a preference of the color?
Was the light brown the town hall tan? That would be correct? Okay.
That's correct.
And that's similar to what we have now, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's correct.
That would be my choice, but I may be on a lonely island.
I actually will join you on your lonely island. Greg's gonna have company.
All right.
The only reason you said light, not dark. Oh, I thought you said dark.
Light. No light.
Oh, because go back to your lonely island, buddy. The reason I say dark is I think because of what you have there. I think the darker color creates less of a contrast with what's already there, and I would rather it just kind of blend in. Personally, but this is an aesthetic conversation, and I prefer more substantive matters, so I really don't care.
Anybody else? I think I tend to go a little bit more towards the darker side, only because lighter tends to reflect light, and I just think maybe it might seem really bright along there when it backs up to houses, trees, that kind of thing. So it's just But I can go with either. So, but
the residents on their side are going to vote for color. So that's it's your own decision.
Yeah, I know that.
Okay.
So we're going to have a contrast between the Trophy Lake side, which is light.
That's right.
And then we're going to have dark on our side. If we go with dark.
That's right.
So Greg's point is that if you go further down past Trophy Lake Drive, the wall is lighter.
Yes, it's that tan color.
Okay. Anybody want to express an opinion here? Please, somebody.
I think it should match what's already there as much as possible. I mean.
All right. So I think lighter is the direction, Stephen, maybe somehow see how close it can match.
I'm off my lonely island. Thank you so much.
We won't say who liked it.
But. Ashlar stone, no coping, tan that matches as close as possible to what we've got.
Yeah.
Which would be the lighter, not the darker.
Yes.
That's correct.
I think so.
Okay. Because there's the town hall tan that they described. The darker one, actually, it's called sable. Is what he had forwarded to me.
Okay. So the only other thing that I had was that we had a discussion, and it's on our future agenda list, about what I think are form liners. Is that the right word? Where there could be some recessed diagram of something in the wall. And so this is really a question for Nancy and Nelson. If we wanted to do some type of form liner, assuming that's the right word, is that the right word? Words? Okay. What's the date you need to know that in order to meet your schedule? Okay, Nelson, she left it up to you.
I'm up. It would probably have to be at the same time that you make your decision on your Ashlar stone and the color, because that has to be incorporated into the plans.
In the plans, okay. So, Council, we haven't had a lot of discussion about it. It was just an idea. Is it important enough to you to do something, or is that something you're not going to worry about? So,
may I interject
for, yes, sir,
for
please.
A moment? And that is that with the location of the wall, any kind of form lining that you do is going to be blocked somewhat by the berm.
That's what I noticed
so
recently,
if
yes.
You're going to want to do something like that, that may be money that could be well spent someplace else.
I looked at that last week. That was like, oh, wait a minute. I'm not sure we'll see much of that. So,
All right.
Everyone okay with it moving forward?
No animals.
All right, so I don't see anybody objecting, Stephen, to moving forward with the colors and design that we have specified. So are you all okay with the decisions tonight?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Comfortable direction? Okay. Anybody else? Comments? All right, we will then move on to item 13. Thank you, Nelson and Nancy, for coming tonight and staying with us.
We have this next item is also related.
Yeah, we got the maintenance agreement. So? Maintenance agreement.
It's all, if we don't do this, it's all a moot point at this, right? Item 13, consider and take appropriate action regarding a maintenance agreement between the town and TxDOT and authorizing the mayor his designee to execute all necessary documents. This is all municipalities that have TxDOT roads running through them already have agreements signed. It just so happens we're a town that has no TxDOT road really running through us. So we've never had an agreement that we signed with TxDOT. Well, all of a sudden now TxDOT is going to construct something inside our town, and we need this agreement. So at this point, I would entertain a motion to approve the agreement.
Where are we here?
I would make a motion to approve the maintenance agreement between the town and TxDOT and authorizing the mayor or his designee to execute all necessary documents.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion by Rowe, seconded by Lamont. Any other discussion? Any questions for our TxDOT representatives who are here? Stephen, anything? We're okay?
Yes, sir.
It's been in review here. All right, all in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Enjoy working with your staff. Thank you. Item 14, consider and take appropriate action regarding the fiscal year 2016 parks projects. Receive an update from staff and discussion of same. So are we going to have presentation to go through?
Mayor and council, I don't have a presentation. I just have an update, which basically coincides with what was in the staff report.
Oh, right.
There were 11 projects that were part of the 2016 budget. So those are the projects that I provided an update on. There have been a few other projects added since that point, which were of council direction, but I didn't touch on those, such as the Veterans Memorial or the parking lots. These are just simply projects that were part of the FY16 budget. So I'll just start at the top. Lakeview Soccer Field, this was a project that was approved by council in previous budgets and was bid and awarded to Greenscaping at the last council meeting. We anticipate the field being operational for that project around August or early September. There was another project, which was to install a new filter on the small pool at the pool facility. That project's complete. Resurfacing of the small pool at the pool facility. To date, contractors have sandblasted the existing surface. There were a couple of cracks in the pool, which they've fixed, and they should be complete resurfacing the pool probably by the end of the week, weather permitting. Changing the alignment of the large slide within the splash pad. Contractors began on-site work on that project on April 20th. It has been turned. There is a pad still, which is in the water, so there's no longer kids that'll be sliding directly onto a hard surface with the pad. They'll be sliding into water with the pad, which will make it a much safer. Removing the ship and several spray pad features to be refinished. We did this. We took those out in early March, shipped those, and those are to be returned and reinstalled next week or the week after that. The bleacher replacement at Harmony Park, council instructed staff not to move forward on that item and instead instructed us to remove the wooden bleachers at Harmony Park, which has been completed. Purchase of a zero-turn mower. That mower has been purchased and is operational. Rehabilitate 8 to 10 cul-de-sac medians. This project's scope of work will utilize in-house staff, and we toured these medians, and we've looked at some different options, which may be just converting those. These are basically medians that are inside of a cul-de-sac. And we've looked at different options, one which may just be making those concrete, making it just a complete concrete cul-de-sac. So that would involve cooperation with the streets department. We anticipate that being complete this summer. The NEO system was another project. It's been disconnected, scheduled to be moved, or it was removed last week. It should be installed at Independence West in May or early June. Toddler playground at Harmony Park. Staff is going over designs with selected Parks and Recreation board members, and we'll bring a design selection to council following their design selection. And then park monument signs. This was a project that was originally to replace some monument signs that had the old logo at some of our parks. And we also had another budget item that included wayfinding signage. Talking with Stephen, we increased this project in scope a little bit to include all of those items, and then also some entryway and median design and signage. So we actually did an RFQ for this, which was advertised in March. There were, I believe, 10 or 11 total responses to that RFQ. Four were chosen to interview, and those interviews were concluded April 22nd. And we would anticipate one or two of those interviewees being asked to prepare a proposal based on their qualifications and based on the scope of the project. And we would hope that would be received early to late May. And then upon acceptance of that proposal by council, design work would begin on the entire scope of that project. So I'd be happy, or Adam, to chime in with some questions if council has questions.
All right. Although this is agendaed to take action, I didn't necessarily see any decisions we might necessarily make, unless I guess we wanted to change a decision that we've talked about in the past. Were there any questions or anything somebody wanted to do? Philip, did you have something?
Yeah, I actually would like to make a motion to allocate $8,000 additional dollars to the toddler playground and take it from what's left out of the line item on the bleacher replacement. I think that's what we have left in that particular fund.
I'll second it.
What did you call it? Toddler?
Toddler playground.
Playground?
Harmony. Yeah.
At which part?
Harmony.
Harmony. We originally had $15,000 allocated for bleacher replacement, and in I looked at the line item, and that line item actually had bleacher replacement and purchase of a new lawnmower. There was some money used for the logo on TC Park, so, or TC Drive, and so it brought it down to about $8,000 that's in that particular budget for bleacher replacement. And since we're actually removing the bleachers, or we have removed the bleachers and we're not gonna replace them, I think that it stays in Harmony, but it perhaps gives a little bit better toddler park for the residents.
All right, any comments, anyone?
I think that's a good idea.
I agree, I like it. Yeah, I like it. All right, all in favor of the motion to allocate $8,000 to the toddler playground at Harmony and take it from what was budgeted for bleachers
replacement,
please show your hand. All opposed, same sign, no opposed, it is passed. Any other items related to this that you wish to address?
I have a couple. First on number 8, the cul-de-sac medians, since I didn't realize we were looking at that, I kind of think, you know, when I first hear that, I kind of think that sounds like a really good idea, because we probably have some medians where they're not big enough where anything can grow.
Well, they're non-irrigated.
They're not irrigated. One or two that are even
their problem.
There's some things growing there.
But they're not things we want to see growing. So. Yeah, so smart idea there.
Let me add a caveat to that. There are some that are hand-watered by a couple of the residents where they've planted things that...
And they look pretty nice.
They look pretty nice, but then some of them don't. And so that's sort of the issue.
Yeah, and that's where I was going to go to that is I don't know if we necessarily need any council action on this, but I'm interested in it just because I do think we have some areas where we have some cul-de-sac medians or weird little areas, maybe where the grade is unique or there's a trees in it or whatever. And the people that live there may consider that just a part of the character of the neighborhood. So, and it sounds like you guys are thinking along the same lines. So that may just be, let's just make sure that we're broadcasting all that info. That way, if anything catches someone's eye, I know so-and-so that lives over there. And that one, I drive by there all the time, and that one looks really nice. Maybe we should hang on to it or whatever. I don't know.
Start with a nod.
The other, but I don't necessarily want to sit here and go, debate every median, and I'm not going there. So the other thing was on the splash pad with reorienting the big slide. One of the things we talked about when we looked at that last summer was how basically all of those runouts are designed to be in water runouts, and we talked about one of the things that might be doable for a few of the others was to raise the water level a little bit to get them slightly underwater. But I think before you could look at that, you need to understand where the slide is going to, this big thing is going to end up. So if that's just something you guys could keep on the radar as a sort of a second phase to that, that would be helpful.
Yeah, one thing they did, and Adam can expound on this, they had to move, I believe, the ship's mast because the slide, the way it had to be orientated, you can't cover up a drain hole.
Mm-hmm.
So it had to be orientated. It was going to slide kind of into one of those masts. So that had to be removed. But other than that, it's going to be a much better product.
And we're trying. It's the dump buckets.
Mm-hmm.
And we're trying to see if there's another spot we can put that has water.
Right.
That's already plumbed. If not, you can expect to see that over mounted in concrete. It's just a feature that I don't want to throw it away just because it's a pricey item. But we're going to see if we can hook that back up to water. But we can raise the level of the splash pad itself to do what you're talking
about. Yeah, and that was just one of the casual conversations we had when we looked at it, because the design of those is whoever did the physics on them thought they were going to be in water, and the ones that aren't are the ones that kids fly off of and go on to skin knees on concrete. So, and I'm an expert on skin knees and concrete. I think that's all the questions I had for now.
So I guess the only question I had that I wanted clarification that based on what Ryland said, are you going to, those cul-de-sac medians that look good, are you going to talk to the citizens about leaving them, or are you just going to take them out?
Yeah, no. I think those ones that there's obviously some ownership, and those we know which ones those are. And I think when we've evaluated those, it's do we do them flagstone? Do we do them DG with some boulders? You know, there's some folks who I think would like to have them completely taken out. And, you know, we go back in and fill in that space just flat as make it a true cul-de-sac, because with issues with parking, it does make it narrow through there. So, right now some people park on them. You know, and so we've got some things that we need to do that we've been looking at and kind of exploring what options are available, what are the cost of each option, and before we actually move forward on that.
All right, I'm just happy that you're talking to people about it. Philip?
Yeah, the cul-de-sac on my street is just concrete. It's there's no circle or no plant, so I mean, that would make sense to me. Because people do park awkwardly, and I can imagine trying to get around. I had a question. Roland and I guess put this on the agenda, but it said staff, so I don't know if this was planned or what. But one of the questions I had is just it seemed like nothing was really getting done. We're 6 months into the budget. We're halfway through. And nothing had been done, and then all of a sudden we request this and things just take off. Now it could be coincidence, I don't know, but it would have been much better to have a lot of this stuff done in the winter time, because now if you go to Harmony, I was there Saturday and then Sunday again, there was a huge event Sunday. Mm-hmm. For Trophy Club families, which I didn't. It was just a coincidence that I happened to be there, because I took my twins, and the park was packed. And so one of the things now is that we have this orange barrier around where the Neos was, and it's we're blocking all of the swing sets. So I don't know if that's something that we can change, if there's really a need for the swing sets to be blocked. But I mean, all of those kids,
we can pull that in.
Had no, yeah. And it might be good to shore up some of that. I actually went back out there today, and it looks like nobody's even looked at it from over the weekend. But kids, and Rylan can speak more to this because it was probably one of his kids that were in the middle. But
no, but I did. I was at the Trophy Club Families event on Sunday, and I had to answer 30 questions. What are y'all doing? And so I answered as best I could with the limited information I had. One of the thought I had was, if we're going to put a real estate sign looking deal that says, pardon our mess, work in progress, on the backside of it, let's laminate something and throw it up and says, coming soon, toddler playground, estimated time of completion, whatever. The temporary barrier, those orange mesh things, they don't stand up to a kid within 100 yards. I was at Bob Jones. I have a 3.5-year-old and a 15-month-old. I'm a VIP at all the local parks. I was at Bob Jones in South Lake 2 weeks ago, and they had a place blocked off, and the kids had already torn it down and were running on it, and it was a tripping hazard just being there. So I took it, being the kind municipal steward that I am, I took it upon myself and cut it free with my pocket knife so at least it wouldn't be a tripping hazard. That was in South Lake. Now, at Harmony, it was kind of, parts of it were good and parts of it were bad, but I was sitting there, and Philip looked right at me, and right then my 15-month-old went right up to it and goes, bink, bink, pulled it down, and she was ready to roll. So I don't know what our options are barricade-wise, but being an actively used park, we should probably figure out a way to make that a little more permanent.
Tim, so we pulled the equipment out of there before we ordered new equipment. Is that true? Okay. So I deal with this in my fitness centers, right? I've opened business, and every 4 to 5 years, I have to literally sell my $800,000 worth of equipment because I'm forced to, and I buy new stuff. We would never move out our equipment before we had an action plan, equipment's bought, and a time when it was coming in, so we would keep that place open and operating as much as possible for the people who use it. So I would caution us next time to do things in a better planning, that we would keep that open to the public for as long as possible. We don't even know what we're getting yet, but we closed the park. It's nonsensical to me. If that was a paying park, we would have to close it. Okay, so moving forward, let's make sure that we dot all our I's and cross all our T's and say, okay, this is open, it's usable now, and until we know what we're doing and we have a timeline of when it's coming in, we do not do this because it looks very bad, not only for the people here, but the people want to use it. You know, right now they can't use it, and they can't use it for no reason. We pulled it out. There was no reason to pull it out because we don't have something going in there, or we should have made it good enough that we could use that part of the park. That's my opinion. Okay, so I would just caution, going forward, when we're doing anything else, can we please cut that timeline down and know what's going on? Because we just said we don't even know what we're putting in there yet, but we closed it. It makes no sense to me. So,
Garrett?
That's my soapbox.
Why did we take it out?
The Neos? It's the one going to Independence West. So, I mean, there was a couple different trades. There was electricians, and there was the playground company itself. So we're a little on their schedule. I agree, it could have been coordinated better. However, and by the way, next week, the only reason we closed it off is there's one of the pads of concrete I thought was a little too high underneath that five bar. As soon as I pop that out next week, then I'll drop the fencing.
But I understand moving what you're forward, saying. If that was your reason why, I would have had that scheduled and popped out and kept it open right away. That's all I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
Anybody else?
Jared, did you finish? No, I think that was my question. I don't understand the logic behind, if we didn't have something to put back there, why we just all of a sudden pull it out.
The Neos is supposed to be primarily in-house for our guys working it. So the electricians were the first on the scene. I'm just saying it could have been coordinated a little tighter, but we have two different projects working. One's an install, one's a taking it out. Yeah, like I said, we could have done it a little tighter.
But you can pull that cement block out and then open.
Yes. Yeah, it's probably fine now. I just thought it was too near the surface. In other words, you might not know it's there because there was a pedestal block. Right. And so I think we can get that the first part of next week, and then I can open the whole thing. I can drop the fencing.
Okay. All right, any other questions in this area? Ryan, or you wanted to ask something?
Tim's comment got me thinking about scheduling. I'd like to see us implement some kind of practice for how we deal with budgeted items like this that have to go out for bid and need to be bid and then selected and then approved by council, so that we, after we have an approved budget, we don't lose momentum. It's bothersome to me that we voted on this, we discussed it last August, we voted on it last September, we adopted it at the end of September, and it was on a Parks Board agenda February 15th, but now we're 2 months and 2.5 months past February 15th, and Parks Board still technically doesn't have what they need to make a decision. And those things do take time, but I find myself going, what happened between October 1 and February, and how can we make sure that with all the balls that are in the air, when we know there's something else that we're not doing in-house or that's going to need to go through multiple bodies to deliberate and decide, and it's going to be an end-user stakeholder thing, that we get those started as soon as possible, because as soon as I explained to people, oh, there's new toddler equipment going in there. Well, park season, it's prime time park season. Why wasn't that done before? And I didn't have an answer. I was like, well, I don't know. You know, I voted for it in September. That's all I can tell you at this point. So I would caution us to make sure we kind of have a plan right after adoption for all those things. And even if the plan means there's delays before we do it, everybody knows that way there's a good expectation and we don't lose time. I thought I had one other thought about that, but I can't think of what it is now. So that's all I have.
That's not a good sign.
I was also curious, the wooden bleachers that are by that tree, is there a reason why those are still in the park, or do you know what I'm talking about?
Up
by the actual playground area straight across.
Are you talking about picnic bleacher?
No, regular bleachers. There's one set of wooden bleachers that are underneath the tree, and I just didn't know if there was a reason that those were still there, or they're kind of odd placed. Did you see those, Rylan?
No.
Yeah.
I'll take a look tomorrow. There shouldn't have been any left. Maybe we moved them from somewhere. I don't know.
Okay.
Oh, I remember what it was now. So I was there on Sunday afternoon, and when I noticed the construction fencing there, and it was, like I said, it was kind of parts of it were down and parts of it were up, and we've now been through two regular weekdays, and it looks the same as it did on Sunday, so we need to make sure when we're putting something up for safety purposes that we have a process in place that's checking the integrity of those things. But
all right, anybody else on item 14? Thank you, staff. Item 15, receive an update and provide direction to staff regarding House Bill 157 and Senate Bill 1160, discussion of same. That starts on page 97 of your packet. There were some what looked like PowerPoint slides. Stephen, were you going to take us through that?
Right. I wasn't going to present them. I was just going to speak through them.
Okay.
And I'll start with the House Bill 157. Generally, these types of things are, you know, designed to restrict us, but this one is actually loosening restrictions on the town or other cities. The previous way that sales taxes were set up was basically you had a 1% general sales tax, which goes to your general fund. You couldn't adopt anything higher or lower than that. Then at the option of the governing body and at the will of the voters, you could go out and approve other special districts or sales tax uses, such as we have, we used to have a 4A and a 4B, and then we reduced the 4B, I believe, and did the street maintenance sales tax, and then we had another election to eliminate the 4A and increase the 4B and do a CCPD. So we're maximizing the total amount that we could have, which is 2%. And what this bill does, it eliminates the cap on the 1% general use sales tax and the other special district cap. So you could have any possibility that you wanted. You could have a 2% 4B sales tax, or you could have 2% general sales tax. The thing about the general sales tax is it can be used for all of the purposes that those other things can be used for. So you can fund street maintenance with your general sales tax. You can fund economic development or community development with your general sales tax. You can fund police operations or fire operations with your general sales tax. It's not restricted. And there's other restrictions on some of those special districts or special sales taxes. For instance, the street maintenance sales tax, we cannot basically reconstruct sidewalks or streets that were constructed after the original election. So anything constructed after 2006, we can't use the street maintenance sales tax on.
Do these, any of these changes, obviously eliminating a special district or adding a special district, were ballot props? designate a fund like street maintenance, does every change require a ballot prop or only certain things?
Everyone.
Okay, so see, this is a real challenge because you're talking major sense to me saying, if we get rid of this stinking street maintenance thing.
This would be one proposition.
Right.
If you wanted to change it.
Right, but my concern is people walk in the voting booth and go, get rid of street maintenance, these people are nuts.
Right.
So I feel like we're kind of in a box.
If it fails, let's say that we send it to the voters and it fails, does it revert back?
It would be exactly the way it is.
So it would revert back right now. So one thing that shocked me in this is that if we cannot use street maintenance on any street in the Highlands.
Correct.
That shocked me when I read that. I had no idea.
Well, the street maintenance sales tax portion.
Right. But still, I mean, you can't use that for streets that you potentially might have problems with because you had that election in 2006. So it's only 2006 streets and older.
Correct.
Which makes not much sense.
Right.
Page 104, the last bullet point, can you explain that? CCPD districts collect less than general revenue sales tax due to being treated as a separate entity by the controller.
Right. And this is, remember, I believe about this time last year, council took action to repeal an exemption on telecommunications sales taxes. By doing that helped us considerably. For instance, the street maintenance sales tax is 0.25%, just like the CCPD. Mm-hmm. But in 2014, the CCPD got $20,000 less than the street maintenance sales tax. Now, part of that is related to that telecommunications sales tax. And part of it is when we get our money from the comptroller, we get one lump sum for the general fund, the 4B, and the street maintenance sales tax. So a special district is a separate thing. It's a separate deposit. So some payers do not recognize that special district. They'll go and they'll pay the 1.75%. They won't pay the 0.25. So we've eliminated a lot of that, but even this year to date, we've collected $3,500 less in the CCPD than the street maintenance sales tax. So, you know, if we're looking at $7,000 difference a year, if you look at, you know, over 5 years, that's a police car. Mm-hmm. That's $35,000.
Are there ways to identify who that is?
We've actually recently contracted with a company called Muni Services, which will search out and try to find businesses that are not compliant and try to get them to get compliant with us. So, and there's a contingent fee based on.
Of course, that costs money.
Right.
Well, what they do is they keep a piece of it, but you weren't getting anything before.
Sure.
And so that's and it's not for forever. So it's for a couple of years.
It's 2 years basically. They get 35% of what they.
But they're auditing to make sure that we're getting exactly what we're supposed to be getting.
So these are businesses that operate in Trophy Club, and they don't realize that we are 8.25. Is that what you're saying?
It may not necessarily be businesses that operate in Trophy Club. It may be an online sale or something like that.
But I would think that they look at. Are they looking? I mean, I would think that they look at Trophy Club, and they it says 8.25%. That. I don't understand how.
Right. Work that way on the sales tax form.
Huh?
I didn't work that way so easy on the sales tax form.
Right.
I guess I fill out a different sales tax form than everybody else.
Well, mine break them down when I my sales tax break down the jurisdiction and everything. It's
that's assuming they listed.
Yeah, I just put it all through.
What I think they're saying is it's not listed.
Right.
Oh.
Just say something.
I just pay Dallas, so I don't. I know there's the full
it down
tax.
Dallas. Right, but it breaks it down the second. Page breaks it all down, the jurisdictions.
You can save some money, maybe.
I just have
Dallas. Oh, wow.
Mine's 8.25 every,
Yeah, Dallas is a simple one. They're in DART, so 1% goes to DART, 1% goes to
But I don't
Dallas.
Break that down. It just does
right.
it for me.
Go
pay
but that goes, because that is considered not a special district. So so that's where it gets, that's how some gets missed, is that
MTA, I think, is the term for it.
For that,
there's a
start.
Because I have it in some places and other places don't.
Will he
it's
ever
easy
return?
To miss.
Will he ever yeah. return?
Right. So what are you asking us to do?
Well, at this point, you know, we've done nothing. So, you know, there are some, I believe there are some potential benefits here. You know, we pay public hearing, you know, we pay for public hearings for the CCPD and the 4B, and we pay, you know, potentially additional audit fees, staff time for all the different funds. But, you know, there are some concerns. You know, one concern is that this bill may be repealed next legislative session. And then, you know, the 4B just issued some debt. So, you know, I would have to reach out to our bond council to see how that could be handled. And then, you know, there's costs associated with an election as well. The direction that I put in the staff report is just, you know, to explore an option. If you want a different sales tax mix or anything like that, we explore an option, which would be basically me asking our bond council if we can do the things with the 4B, if you wanted to change the 4B or any of the other items.
How would you handle the CCPD money transferring to the general fund to pay for the police facility, the
well,
bond?
You would just, well, actually the town
that's
is
separate.
Paying for that. The
so the town, so already the town is already paying for it, so it's just
that's
a tra-
cool.
it's just right. a it's just an in and out transfer, so there's no effect on that.
Right.
They just EDC, yeah.
And EDC the same thing with
no,
the
EDC
oh.
actually
issued
the debt.
Separate corporation.
That's right. It's not a special district. Okay.
Right. And so, you know, from a staff perspective, I think it's our obligation to bring forward to you information related to financing aspects of the town. You know, I can see where some folks may have an issue with this for whatever reasons. There's advantages and disadvantages, but we want to be able to bring it to you, let you know this is what the law currently allows you to do based upon the state legislature and what they've done to restrict cities over the past and school districts over the past few sessions. It's anticipated that this probably will go away. So if you want to consider doing it, you would have to place this on the November ballot. It's not something you have to decide tonight. You would obviously have some questions we would have to answer with our financial advisor and bond council, but it's something that if you would like for us to continue to explore, we can do that as a staff.
Rylan?
My general thought is I'm tempted by the idea of simplification. And I'm sure that with the different things you guys have to deal with on the financial side, that you probably see things much the same way. So I support seeing some options. EDC 4B might be difficult since they issued their own debt, but if everything else could be rolled up, seems like it would be streamlining operations, which I'm all about. A question is, you say it's anticipated that this might get repealed. Having just been passed, what is leading the anticipation that it might be repealed?
That was just the update that the attorneys from when I go to my government finance officers conference, they always have a legislative update from some of the council of Texas Municipal League. So that was just his comments on what he thought.
Were they in favor of this initially or no? Do you guys
this
remember?
Is one, well, this is one they actually would be in favor of. They're very much on our side.
I was wondering if I'm trying to break down the psychology of it, if they're afraid somebody's going to come spoil their party or whatever. So, okay.
Well, the trend has been for the state to either restrict cities' funding mechanisms or try to.
Mm-hmm.
And so we know that revenue caps, property cap, you know, all that stuff will come back. You know, even the concern about issuance of COs, you've already, you know, we've had that issue where a failed GO bond election can't issue COs. So, you know, this is sort of, this may be, and who knows, but it could be if you wanted to broaden our 2% and how you allocate that into a more general sense with a little less restrictions at times, this is an opportunity to do that while the law we know is on the books. We can't say what they may or may not do.
Yeah.
My guess is that some legislatures may not find this maybe to their liking.
Well, it already passed. We've had this conversation before. In broader terms, things like with EDC, at some point, we're going to be built out. The opportunity for development is going to be in fits and starts. I have always worried about sitting here trying to decide how to spend, hopefully, a vastly increased sales tax allocation under the parameters set forth by the state. And you and I had the conversation, well, the state is dictating. So anything that pushes accountability and decision-making down, this sounds great.
So I got a couple of comments. There are pros and cons to this. It's attractive to me that it's less busy work, so to speak. Bookkeeping, meetings, publications, seems to be simplified, which is attractive to me, like Ryland was saying. I made a note that I'm going to reach out to our two representatives and our senator to see their feeling. And Metroport Cities Partnership, who we're a member of, just contracted with a legislative consultant to update us monthly on what's happening, expected to happen, and what's going on right now. And I'll touch base with that legislative consultant about what they're seeing from people in our area on this so that I can report back. And I'll send you a link to the document that's a report, Stevens. So if you want to read that.
Yeah, please do.
There's a lot of data, and then it's summarized so that you can don't have to read everything that you're after.
Quite frankly, I'm surprised that this passed. And then I'm also, in light of other cities that don't have the opportunity for 4B, like a Dart City, for example, that's always been a discussion item about whether or not there should be an additional 1% that's voted upon for those cities, or for those cities that don't have, like we don't participate in a mass transit or any type of transportation. That discussion seems to get bogged down, so I'm surprised that they kind of almost loosened the restrictions of sorts.
Well, some cities have the problem if they've maxed out their 2%.
That's right.
And let's say that you wanted to somehow provide funds of some type of mass transit aspect that's happening in Tarrant County with the TRE, you have no way to do that.
That's right.
This gives you the flexibility that you could do that in some fashion. And in some of those places, like the new line that's expected to go from downtown Fort Worth out to Grapevine, you don't get a station unless you participate financially.
That's correct.
And those that are maxed out say, well, where do I get that from? Well, it's going to come from general fund unless you decided I'm going to take it from some sales tax. One of the cons I'll have is there's already been discussion in town by people who have painted this particular item being on the agenda as a negative. Saying that council is wanting to get rid of CCPD and EDC-4B only because they read this in the packet. And we hadn't even discussed it.
Who said that? I didn't hear that at all.
Well,
all the mad people come straight to Nick. That's what we just learned.
No, actually, it came third hand to me that somebody made the statement at a meet and greet. In a fashion, at least the way it came to me, was it was negative because this council is going to get rid of CCPD and EDC. So that was the statement, and I'm kind of going, where did that come from? And then when you read the packet, you go, oh, I can see where they construed that without even knowing all the facts or hearing the discussion. So I just wanted to bring it up so people understood that's not necessarily where we're headed. Me personally, I would like to at least see some more research. I don't know how the rest necessarily feel. The only other thing is I don't want to have a special election in November that I have to pay for just to do this. So it would be nice if I could have done it when we have another election.
We'll have a November election.
Someone's running?
Yeah, you have a presidential election.
The legislation, they meet when?
They'll go into session in January.
But the new laws wouldn't go into effect until we had
next September.
I think so.
Yeah.
Well, but
what we could do is ask TML what their thoughts are on if we did this under a May election.
Well, okay, here's my political question. This was just passed by the past body, House and Senate, unless there's a drastic changeover of House and Senate seats, you really think they would just go back and change something that they approved?
But there's a possibility. So, but you know, the thing about it is, I certainly support this for the streets fund, because it's what's amazing to me is the very people that are, you know, causing our sales tax to go up is new residents moving in. And so if you can't repair any street using that money past 2006, that makes no sense to me.
Yeah, see, I see an advantage. That's the reason I see one of those advantages. It's like, well, in the future, I'd like to have more flexibility. But if it's coming to the general fund, I'm going to spend money for streets wherever I need to spend it on.
Right.
It wouldn't be designated.
No, that's what I'm saying. That one I would certainly support, you know, as a no-brainer.
So I think I'd like to see more information, talk to BOD Council, let's do some research, get some info from elected officials to see what's happening, and we can bring it back if that's okay with everybody. All right. Thank you for bringing that forward. I appreciate it. Item 16, consider and take appropriate action.
I still have a Senate Bill 7.
Oh, that's right. Well, okay.
This one's not nearly as exciting, I can assure you.
It's so robust to me.
This one should be a little bit shorter, but definitely not as exciting. This is a bill that deals with property taxes, and there's a few changes. One that doesn't affect us is they basically change the notice posting, which we have to post our notice of public hearing in the paper before September 1st. They change that to September 1st, or 30 days from when we get the appraisal roll. Well, Denton County Appraisal District and Tarrant County Appraisal District always get us our appraisal rolls usually before July 25th, so that really doesn't apply to us. Our date would still be September 30th. One change that will affect us is that now if the council was proposing a tax rate that exceeded the effective tax rate, it would require a minimum of 60% approval. Now, because we have 7 members and not 5, if we had 5, it would be a simple majority, 3-2. Because we have 7, it requires the approval of 5 of the 7 council members to adopt a tax rate that exceeds the effective tax rate. So if it's 4-3, then the property tax rate does not pass if it's exceeding the effective rate. The other change with this bill is it requires language to be added to all of our notices or ballot language with regards to tax rates that exceed the effective rate. So it would basically read that the Town of Trophy Club proposes to use the increase in total tax revenue for the purposes of, and then we would describe the purpose of the increase. Texas Municipal League really didn't have any guidance on what that language should be. So right now, staff would recommend that it would read, the Town of Trophy Club proposes to use the increase in total tax revenue for the purpose of funding programs approved in prior years plus the following supplemental request, and then we would list supplemental requests. If council has a different direction that you would like to see in that notice, as I said, there's no guidance at this point, so I think we can put anything we want in there at this point.
I think it'll come down to understanding what it is we are setting the rate at and what some of our larger ticket items are in a given budget with capital projects and things of that nature.
This one's not a huge deal, but it is a change. It will also change the cost of what it will change the cost that we have to do within public notices. And so that will go up because you're adding more lines and more text. And so this is, again, an FYI of letting you guys know kind of what are the changes coming up as we kick off into budget season.
We'll put that one in this. If we exceed effective, we will for sure put in compliance with Senate Bill 1760.
Yeah.
What they need to change is make a notice of what's going to happen when there's no more newspapers.
Well, and that's been a debate about whether or not it should be
just on our website.
Just on a website, or how does that work? Because Obviously, the newspaper lobby is intent on trying to keep that, because in reality, cities and counties, governmental entities do have to pay because of the way the laws are written. So we're obligated. So we're customers.
Yeah, dead men walking.
So
it's not agenda for that.
I just know wording on a lot of things that are put on the ballot don't make a lot of sense personally. So I wish somebody would figure out how to make them written so that they actually were understandable by people. That'd be my preference. All right, any other discussion about this item? All right, item 16, consider take appropriate action regarding a mid-year financial report for financial years 2016. Lots of good information here comparing. Did y'all want to say anything about this, Stephen or Stephen?
Mayor, this is basically, if you remember, I believe most of you were on the council at that time, we changed what was a very condensed monthly financial report to the version that you see before you, which is what we give you each month. Basically, for the mid-year, we just put it on the regular agenda and add a brief description of some items. Overall, we're in really great shape. 77% of revenue received in the general fund against 43% expenditures in the general fund. So overall, in great shape. I'd be happy to answer any questions about that.
I appreciated the summary of the discrepancies and why.
I have two questions, so that you know that I've looked at it. When do we typically get paid or reimbursed from NISD for the SRO program?
Well, it's been between, I believe, January and about now. We just recently sent them the bills for those. I believe we had some officers that weren't there some days, so I think we're going to have to revise our invoices to them. So we should get a little bit less than what we budgeted, just because we had some officers that weren't.
Okay. I just noticed a zero, and at this point in time, my other years are saying that we got full payment, so that kind of caught me.
Yeah, I believe that they used to tell us to send them the bill, and maybe they had some turnover there. So, yes, we recognized that about a month ago, and we're on top of it.
And then the EMS run revenue is down 7% from last year. We don't get a EMS report as comprehensive as the MUD does, but I went back to their packet. They didn't have one this month, probably because of the change, I'm sure. But last month, 2015, they had 172 EMS runs, and this year 168. So we're actually a little bit lower. And so I'm just wondering, we had a problem at one point of collection. And so I'm just wondering, is our collection holding up, or is that?
One thing that we did was we got a third party collection agency for those amounts that were or accounts that were after 6 months. Unfortunately, that company went out of business. So I'm in the process of contracting with another company that actually does our property tax collections for some of those past due accounts, which are only to out of district customers, not to residents. We don't bill them for anything that their insurance or whatever doesn't pay for. So hopefully we should have them on board in the next month or so.
So it may be a combination of. Okay, that's all I had. Just want to make sure you knew I was looking at it.
No doubt. We knew you were looking.
I looked at it too. So, on that note, that because you brought up NISD, Stephen and I both had an opportunity to talk to Tim McClure, who is the Dennis McQuarrie replacement for NISD that deals with all facilities. Both of us talked to him about re-examining their participation in the Lakeview Fields. Now that we understand, based on somebody at Lakeview saying, we can't wait till you finish it so our kids can go out there and play, when we were the assumption they weren't going to use it. So Stephen, I know, has it on his agenda to meet with Tim McClure about that, and I've mentioned it to him also.
I have a meeting with him next week, and it's about the opportunity to, we need to revise or re-examine some of our use agreements and joint use agreements. in light of kind of where we're at today and where they were. If we need to update those, let's update those and clear out and or spell out some of that language. And then where are some opportunities for us to partner? And let's start having those discussions. So I found Tim to be very receptive, very open-minded, and I look forward to our meeting next week.
And it makes sense because you could actually expand, you know, because we're not doing the whole piece of property, and so it might be an opportunity to do a lot more on that piece of property.
Yep. All right. It's agenda on 16 to take appropriate action. Do we need to take action to receive the financial reports?
I don't think you have to. I don't think it's a policy.
Okay. I didn't think so, but okay. All right. So unless someone wants to move that, we will just move forward having received it. Item 17, consider and take appropriate action regarding an ordinance amending various provisions of Article 2.01, General Provisions of Chapter 2, Animal Control of the Town of Trophy Club Code of Ordinances, adopting provisions regulating the keeping of fowl within the town, providing a penalty not to exceed $2,000 for each offense, and providing an effective date. We need to move Ordinance 2016-17. And there may be some other issues that we have with that. So staff, any comments?
No, we tried to include everything that we discussed at the last meeting to include the nuisance ordinance. Mm-hmm. So there's a nuisance section in here, and all we did was add the definition of foul and one other thing.
I have some questions whenever.
Go ahead, Philip.
This is probably for Pat or Ron. I think in that ordinance it says that we're going to charge a permit fee for coop construction. So that one is not, I don't think that's in our schedule of fees for coop construction, so we'd probably have to add that. And two, what actually are you looking for on coop construction? I don't know that I may have caught you off guard that you didn't know that there was going to be a permit required for coop construction. But
I do know for a fact we don't have a coop construction permit fee. I know that.
We actually had a discussion about this because there's a permit fee called for in the ordinance, and Pat looked at it, and there's a miscellaneous section that apparently we use for general or permits when we don't have something specifically.
Okay, and how much is that? 75. And what exactly... So here's the question. It said that's required if you it was kind of convoluted, and I don't have it in front of me, but it said, actually I do, it said that it was required if you were going to go to the maximum, you know. If you read, and I'll find it while you tell us about the $75, I guess.
Well, we simplified our fee schedule a couple of years ago, and there was a lot of things that required all kinds of calculations, and it took longer than it was worth. And we've got a lot of our fees, like single trade permits, and we've got that miscellaneous, and they're all $75. That's what if it's a one-trip inspection or one-trip time, it's a $75 fee, and so that's what that's based on.
Okay, so if you look at page 163 of the packet, it says 3 coop required, and then it says permit required for maximum size. So it makes it sound like if you're building the maximum size, then you have to have a permit. But if you're not, then you don't have to have a permit. So that may be Patricia.
A heading just may need to change then. Just say permit required and remove the maximum size.
Yeah, because the next sentence does say a permit shall be required for the construction of a coop. Now, I guess the question then becomes, if you go to Tractor Supply, is that the one? That's the one down there. They sell coops that are kits that you can build. Are we going to require a permit for a kit to be built, or are you talking? You know what I'm saying?
We don't.
New construction.
Yeah, I mean we don't on accessory structure. If it's under 100 square feet, we don't require it. So I guess it could fall under that. Coop's a little bit different though. I mean, it's not something I've thought about. If it requires it, we can, but something that's a kit that gets moved around. I don't know how I would permit that.
You know, I had rather, to me, I would rather, if this is just me personally, instead of having a permit fee to build a coop, I would rather have a registration fee so that we know where the coops are. That's kind of where I would.
I think the intent, talking with Kelly, was more directed towards an inspection fee of the coop to make sure the coop existed.
Right.
And that the coop was in the appropriate place, because we do have limitations of how close to the fence it can be to a structure and things like that. So it's more of an inspection fee of the coop.
So maybe a registration fee would be better than a permit.
Yeah, that was my concern. If you don't have some way of charging or requiring a permit, they're not going to conform to the 10-foot rule or that kind of thing, is my impression.
So don't you think that would be better as a registration fee than a permit fee, you know, in that situation?
Can we call it an inspection? What would be?
Registration fee would catch that, but it would go, yeah, Kelly would go out and inspect it, but that would give us a, that would recoup our money to go out there and.
Right, you know. Right.
Okay.
Rylan?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion. I'd make a motion that we approve ordinance 2016-17, amending various provisions of Article 2.01, General Provisions of Chapter 2, Animal Control of the Town of Trophy Club Code of Ordinances, adopting provisions regulating the keeping of fowl within the town, providing a penalty not to exceed $2,000 for each offense, effective April 26, 2016, with the amendments being as follows. Definitions of coop and fowl as specified in the packet, and the definition of nuisance in section 2.01.020 as defined in the packet.
We have a second?
I'll second that.
I have a motion by Rowe, seconded by Reed, to approve the ordinance.
I'd like to make an amendment to that.
With the amendment.
Tell you what I'm thinking first.
Okay.
The definition of the coop and fowl as specific, and then there was a, what was the second
and
part?
The definition of nuisance. Basically everything as presented, omitting the section about, section 3 about coops. And I'll tell you what I'm thinking on that.
All right, Rylan.
The reason I'm thinking of that, looking at it that way, is I think we could save ourselves some trouble, because if someone decides to keep a coop over 100 feet, Pat's already, or 100 square feet, Pat's already said at that point it qualifies as an accessory structure. So they've already got a lot of things to go deal with as a result of that. If it's below 100 square feet, I don't know why we care, given what we have in Section 5 under defining any conditions back there as a nuisance. My thought with that is, rather than subject us to a long debate getting into how we're gonna tinker with how people do things in their backyards under 100 square feet, if it's over 100 square feet, we already have rules for that, no matter what it is. It could be a coop. It could be a place to keep your Barbies. It doesn't matter. The concern is effect on adjoining property owners, and in my opinion, the nuisance section as written is pretty exhaustive and covers that. So maybe we can simplify the way we deal with it.
So you're removing what?
The section 3 where the Cooper, just remove the Cooper requirement.
Okay, so you're keeping 4 though.
Yeah.
It's not really okay. Section.
Sorry, it's item 3. Yeah.
Chapter 2, section 3.
On page 163.
Yes.
What you're dealing
yes,
with.
Sir.
Okay, Greg, I think you wanted to try to say something.
I'd like to make an amendment let's see, that would be Chapter 2, Section 4, Bullet Point Number 2, to read.
Wait just a second.
Okay, go ahead.
Are you amending his amendment?
Yes, just adding something.
All right.
To read, be located a minimum of 10 feet from rear and side lot lines and shall not be located within 100 feet of any residence, business, or commercial establishment or office or school.
Second.
Can we discuss?
Yes, yeah, so now the amendment to the amendment is on the floor, and that's what you need to discuss.
That is a premeditated poison pill from the Mayor Pro Tem and Councilman Schaffner. Let's be perfectly clear about what that is. That's a premeditated poison pill to try to regulate chickens out of existence. It's a very progressive strategy. Pick a word that's been thrown around the last couple months.
Are you talking in favor of the amendment?
I'm against it.
Against that. Come on, Nick.
There are locations.
I just wanted to clarify exactly what you're putting
right. Well, I'm just mirroring Roanoke. I mean, our neighbors to the west of us.
There are locations in Trophy Club where this could happen.
Yes, it could. And half the town has HOAs that don't allow them. So
good for them.
Well, seeing as though you're, I wanted to bring up a point, but I'm not sure it deals with the amendment. What I wanted to deal with doesn't deal with your amendment. So, anybody else want to comment on the amendment to the amendment?
I fully support it. It's a good amendment. I think it's well thought out.
I'm glad we finally found something tonight we disagree on. I knew it would come around.
Are we having a balanced debate here?
Mayor Pro Tem Lamont, would you reread your
amendment? I most certainly would. That's Chapter 2, Section 4, Bullet Point Number 2 to read. Be located a minimum of 10 feet from rear and side lot lines and shall not be located within 100 feet of any residence, business, or commercial establishment, or office or school.
Or tree or air or ground.
Okay. Did we get that? All right, any other discussion?
Good amendment.
I'm not going to vote for that amendment, just to let anybody else know.
Shame.
Where's my chicken dance? Let me get the chicken dance going. Yeah.
All right, are we ready to vote? All those in favor of the amendment to the amendment, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. The motion fails. Voting for was Lamont and Schaffner. So the amendment to the amendment failed.
Or really, it's just amendment to the motion.
And
motion just contained.
Yeah, there was only one amendment. There's no other amendment.
And for reference,
an amendment to the amendment.
No.
It's amendment to the motion. You can't make a second amendment to the motion until you deal with the first amendment.
We made a motion with amendments to it, yeah.
Right, but mine was a main motion and not an amendment.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
I wrote an amendment. I'm sorry. You're right. All right.
And for the record, we did find two houses where the
only you two would go look it up.
Stating that wrong. Because you said
no, I'm just made. My motion is the main motion. But it's an amendment to the the ordinance.
I'd like to make an amendment. This is a serious one. I'd like to make a motion that we add this, I guess number 4 it would be now that we've taken out one, or we may take out one. This section shall not apply to pet birds kept within residential or commercial structures, nor shall it apply to birdhouses for keeping of migrating or wild birds.
Where are you amending?
Under nuisance.
It would just be another bullet, another number.
You're adding to nuisance? Or
no, I'm adding another section.
Another paragraph? And so would you read it again?
This section shall not apply to pet birds kept within residential or commercial structures, nor shall it apply to birdhouses for the keeping of migrating or wild birds.
Do you have a second?
I'll second that.
All right, so you have an amendment on the floor. Any discussion?
I think that's a good catch. I like that.
Motion made by Schaffner, seconded by Lamont. Any other discussion? Hearing none, call for the vote. All those in favor of the amendment, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. The amendment passes unanimously. All right, so we're back to the motion as amended, and I need a point of clarification.
Ryland, did
not really an amended motion. It's a motion. I think he said.
Oh, geez.
It's amended now.
It's amended now.
Yes, he amended.
Amended. Sorry, I'll turn around.
I know you're trying to just make me talk about it.
I'm lobbying to be mayor pro tem. It's not working out real good for me.
All right, Garrett, will you explain to me exactly
what we're doing here? I got more votes than Ryland, so they made me come up here.
I'm sorry. Okay. Ryland, did you remove that paragraph 3 totally so coop is not defined?
No, I left the definition of coop because the word coop is used subsequently in the ordinance, but I removed the portion of the ordinance that would enforce the requirement that the coop be present.
Okay. So here's the only thing I see missing from this based on previous discussions. There were examples given at previous presentations about chicken coops that the feeling was that you needed to have a run, an area where chickens could get out of the coop but stay inside a fence and get exercise. I think is what the purpose was.
Right, and that's actually why I wanted to strike three altogether. That way, we're not trying to define and enforce the logistics of the backyard. We're just instituting a definition for what the nuisance is if things go left. Was my thought.
Okay. So, but it seemed like this definition was X square feet. But I guess if they wanted to have a run, they would just have to figure out what the square feet for it that is.
Well, it doesn't matter. Yeah, they can. At this, basically, my thought process is it's basically like it is today in terms of the way it would be put together in the backyard. If there's a structure, the town only cares about it if it's over 100 square feet. And if it's not a structure, if you're talking about a run where they've got chicken wire or whatever, it's fine as long as it doesn't create a nuisance, which would be as it would be with anything else. If you had something out there for your dog, it would be okay as long as it didn't create a nuisance. If you had something out there for your hamster, it would be okay as long as it didn't create a nuisance.
So in the past, it seems like we've had a problem enforcing nuisance. The chief is coming back in. So what I'm questioning is enforcement of what's considered a nuisance. If this happens and they've got a coop, it's interpreted as it's a nuisance by the neighbors. How do we deal with it? Can we make them remove it? Can we fine them?
We can fine them up to $2,000.
And if it becomes more egregious, then we'll take them to court. That's where Patricia comes in. But in terms of it's up to Kelly, Kelly will go out, but it's going to be the complaint. And we'll get a written complaint. We'll send an officer out, take statements, and just build the case.
It's similar to a barking dog.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how often does that happen? It's rare. But it does happen. You know, where someone's dog will bark all the time, and that will escalate up, and then eventually you deal with it, either through working through staff, hopefully with the neighbors. But there are things and provisions in there on how to handle something like that. Same thing with this is that, you know, as long as that homeowner is working to ensure that the area is clean and protected and not causing a problem to an adjacent property owner, a lot of that's education and working with those homeowners. You know, our goal is compliance and trying to be a good neighbor.
All right. All those in favor of the motion as amended, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. I believe I hear rain. Is that right?
Yeah, it just hit us.
Yeah, it's.
But it's not the severe, based on my weather map. But
yeah. We got another just 10, 15 line. Minutes.
I'm watching the storm here. Keeping us safe. All right, item 18, items for future agenda to include discussion of agenda items for consideration on the upcoming regular session council agenda for May 10th meeting and discussion of the town council future agenda items list to include discussions of the below items from the future agenda list, item A, item number 7 on the future agenda list, and item number 8 on the future agenda list.
Anybody have comments about that or things? I do have something, but I have to find it.
Mayor and Council, I have a meeting scheduled with Jennifer McKnight for this week to discuss a few items such as the fire ILA. So be able to provide an update to you later this week or early next week.
All right, anybody else? Well, I know that I added to mine the fire ILA. The issue that I'm concerned about is that from everything that was included in video of the MUD meetings, I haven't seen them take any action or give any direction about the agreement. In fact, I've seen quite the opposite, to where they seem to be going down the path of investigating all ways to not sign an ILA and hire their own people. That's what I'm seeing. So I have this concern that we're getting no communications from them about what they would like to see in the ILA. And they're headed down a path to, in essence, separate and do their own thing. So I think that's a severe financial impact to both entities. And so I'm glad you have a meeting with them. So I just want to make sure that on our next council agenda that we have something to begin to deal with the ILA. And it could be that we table it. It could be that there's just no discussion. But I don't want us to not have an opportunity to discuss something that happened at the last minute.
That's correct. And we are with the cancellation, with the MUD cancellation of that contract prior to April 1st, we are under a deadline of September 30th at midnight, because at that point, fire service will not exist for the PID and other properties, and we have, as the town is the employer of all the firefighters, we do have that issue. And so something has to be worked out, and if not, then as the town, we need to be coming up with some alternative strategies to be able to provide that service to our residents to ensure that they're protected. It's our duty to ensure that the health, safety, and welfare of our residents is addressed. It's one of our primary, it's the primary mission.
I guess if my feeling at this point is if at your meeting you don't see significant hope, significant actions that you feel like will get there, then I feel very strongly that we need to look for contracts with other agencies to serve our citizens. Because it looks like we would have no agreement. We would have a set of employees. The employees would be in a situation where they have to decide where do they want to go to work. We would be overstaffed because we wouldn't need all of them to run the ambulances. We would have a place for an ambulance or a place for people to sleep. And I really just think that the action the MUD took without any proposal of change was a very poor decision. I requested specifically of President Moss about those, what was the problem with the existing agreement as to why you would cancel it. I've asked MUD directors that same question. I have gotten nothing in writing specific. And so from what I see is their direction is we don't plan on doing anything, because if they planned on trying to solve the problem, they would have been back, in my opinion. So I'm very concerned about that, Council. So, Rylan?
How many times have they met since they notified us of cancellation, roughly?
Too many?
They met twice, but they received it right before their meeting when they sat down. So they didn't. I think the attorney had one meeting where she talked to them about.
I believe they canceled it in February.
Yeah.
And so they've met in
March and April.
Okay,
so they've had two opportunities to provide direction that would indicate to Jennifer what amendments or changes from what we floated them would be amenable to them, or not even taking it that far, to simply provide some clue as to the specific reasons why the cancellation was issued in the first place. Okay, and we're still waiting on both of those pieces of information. Okay.
You know, the motion that they came out basically rejected what we sent. I mean, it wasn't here's the items we want you to fix. It was a rejection because they said that we combined two, and the other motion was to explore all options and bring them back to the board. So it wasn't, I mean, it wasn't really a go back to the town and tell them this and this is what we want to change. It was saying that they rejected it and they want to know their options moving forward. So I kind of agree with the mayor that we have an obligation to at least explore our options and be prepared, you know, in case something does happen. I think we have that responsibility.
Just
Greg, and then
and let's not lose sight of they were the lead dog in canceling this arbitrarily without any suggestions, amendments, or how to make the plan better. Just boom, canceled.
Garrett, and then Chief.
We're talking about future agenda, right? What we're going to talk about.
Okay. So just my two cents is I would like to understand what the ramifications are, when it expires. I think we all get that, but I'd like to see a presentation of that on the agenda. And then I would like to see what all of our options are. And I mean, it's we don't have ambulances anymore because we're working with Roanoke, and so then the MUD getting something for this. I mean, what are all the, and I think we need to list them out. And I mean, clearly that's not what I want to do. I mean, I think we all want to get this thing solved. But I agree 100% with Nick. We need a presentation and we need to know what we're up against because, I mean, we could be put in a really quickly awkward position. So we need to know where we're going.
Chief?
And then I have a comment. Real quick, I met with their committee that's working on their policies and procedures last Tuesday, and they provided us a copy of their short-term goals that they're working off of their assessment that was done by the company they brought in to assess the fire department. And on that remarks section, they did comment on three areas that they wanted to see in the ILA. And Patricia and I have been trying to hash that out to see how to fit that in, but it's all related around the comments about the chief, the fire chief, how to look for one, what the duty should be, and stuff like that. But that was the only information they provided to me about including in the ILA in the future.
So that was from the committee made up of Neil Toomey, director, and a citizen, but not directed from the board.
Right. No. Correct? That was strictly.
Is this an ad hoc committee, or did they actually appoint this committee?
They appointed it.
I'm not sure.
To work with the consulting firm report.
Is my impression.
Just some information.
Yeah. So item 8 on future agenda. It says discussions of interlocal agreements with TC Mud 1 for fire services and building services such as trash, drainage, etc. The agreement they canceled the ability for them to bill for trash, drainage, those kinds of things on their billing, and doesn't really have anything to do with fire, but that was in that ILA, and if they're not going to continue to put that on their bill and therefore provide that billing service, then we have to find a billing service, and that's going to be hugely expensive.
It's actually two separate ILAs.
Right there. It also cancels our collection of their permit fees and things like that. So.
As well as maintenance of this facility, landscaping maintenance of this facility, and basically this property from the Savore building towards the police station. The maintenance here. Or in terms of we do the outdoor maintenance.
You know, I understand that what they were trying to do is say those contracts have a cancel by date. If you don't do it by this date, it renews. And so they were giving notice saying unless we fix it, we're not going to renew is one way. And so they took the option to cancel, but I just haven't seen a lot of action to try to solve something. Okay, so I have a notice that sirens are going off, and from a citizen that says they can't tell if that's Trophy Club or Roanoke.
Yeah, we're talking to Roanoke, so as soon as Roanoke sets ours off, we're going to set ours off. So
somebody's reporting that they're hearing sirens.
Maybe South Lake, because it's
okay.
Yeah,
radar.
Or Keller, storm, maybe Westlake Keller.
Okay. All right. So I think what Garrett requested for future agenda was a presentation about our options in dealing with fire, EMS, and I don't know if you can have that ready for the next council meeting or not, but.
I think I can give you an update on where we stand and what options may be available. I know that it's something that I've been exploring and looking at. And so I think I can kind of give you some ideas of what to do and where to go. And, you know, from there, some additional research and would probably be needed.
All right. Anything else on future agenda or the next agenda? All right. At this point, I would consider a motion to remove from the table item number one, and we would therefore convene back into executive session and continue with the review of town attorney. Do I have a motion to remove from the table?
I'll make a motion to remove item one from the table.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Second.
So I have a motion to remove from the table item one by Councilmember Rowe, seconded by Mayor Pro Tem Lamont. Any discussion? All those in favor, show your hands. It is unanimous. We are removed from the table. We are going back into executive session pursuant to the following designated sections of Texas Government Code, annotated 551, Texas Open Meeting Act. The council will convene into executive session to discuss the following. Section 551.074, personnel matters to discuss or deliberate, the appointment, employment, evaluation, reassignment, duties, discipline, or dismissal of a public officer or employee, and Section 551.071, 1 and 2, consultation with attorney, seeking advice of its attorney regarding pending or contemplated litigation or a settlement offer, or to consult with its attorney on a matter in which the duty of the attorney of the governmental body under disciplinary rules of professional conduct of the State Bar of Texas clearly conflicts with the Open Meetings Acts. Patricia Adams, town attorney, is item one. It is 9:52. It is 11:41, and we will reconvene after executive session. We will go to item two. Consider take appropriate action regarding the executive session. Anyone wish to make a motion?
I thought you were making it.
I move that pursuant to our review of Patricia Adams, the town attorney, that we document the items that have been discussed and goals and objectives.
I'll second that.
All right, Sanders has a motion, Lamont seconded. Any discussion? For sake of people viewing, it was our annual review of the town attorney. We went through individual evaluation of Patricia. We then did it as a group, and we developed a list of goals and objectives to work on, some of which are joint goals and objectives that involve council and other staff. Any other comments from anybody? All right. Hearing none, all approval of the motion, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is unanimous. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll move to adjourn.
Second.
We'll move. Lamont seconded. All in favor, show your hands. All opposed, same sign. It is 11:43. We are adjourned.